Did she die to Bubble Boss?
No.
How is that entertainment then? Well, since I only have one eye for the duration of 1 week, Shikroxen told me I can't beat him in Mega Man 4 with only one eye.
That, yes, okay, that.
So we're doing two stages from Mega Man 4, and Shikroxen can pick the stages, and let's see if I still have it with one eye or not. What are we doing first?
Pharaoh and Brightman. We are doing Brightman first.
You're an idiot.
What? Just suddenly changes it. Asshole.
I don't like this.
Wow, what a jerk thing to do.
We could do Brightman.
No, I do think Brightman is the better option here.
You think so?
Yes, I did play some Risk of Rain, and I gotta admit it's a lot harder than I thought it would be with one eye. The depth perception is all fucked up. I can't tell what's what. You can do the countdown, you Swedish bastard. Let's get this over with.
Hold your horses.
I'm holding my horse.
Calm your tits.
I'm holding my... calming...
One. Oh, right, that's the wrong way.
That's...
Two.
Mm-hmm.
One.
Oh my goodness.
Go.
I went.
Wow.
In my
sounds chance. Like,
We're going Brightman, right?
Yes.
Holy shit, I can't see shit. Hold on. It's gonna be exciting.
Robin Iron, Sheik, I'm gonna laugh if he beats you.
I'm gonna laugh as well. Oh, I made the blind jump.
Same.
Blind jump.
Oh, I get it. Blind jump.
I think you need the blind jump. That's like the hardest thing in the level.
Yep. Don't worry, guys, I'm not dying or anything. I'm just
bullshite.
A low devil for this week. Ooh! I took 2 hits from the gummy ball machine.
The first
Nico, you better not lose this.
I will lose. I will
fly to Finland and beat you with a baseball bat.
This is
that
so hard.
Fun.
I'm okay with this.
I mean... Try doing any stage with one eye. You hope you never tried. It's not as bad
as you play Mega Man with my eyes closed all the time.
Where are you at, Shikroxen?
Over there.
So I'm winning
Thank
this.
Thank you for using my answer.
Mm-hmm. I'm done with the Mantis Eye. And no, it's not Mantis's ultimate Mantis Eye.
No, it is Mantis's.
No, Mantis Eye.
Man.
Get it right.
Bullshit.
Mantis Eye. What?
Mantis don't have eyes.
I didn't die. I'm alive.
I died.
Did you now?
I did. But you are gonna get raped on Brightman himself, so.
Yes. There's a bullet. I died just before the gate.
Yes, I'm him.
You're a head, I'm just a torso. I'm envious.
I'm raping you on Mega Man 4.
I wonder
this
why.
Is my game now.
This is my game.
Every win is a win.
No, it's not.
It is in Sweden.
There is
Shut
still
up.
Another stage.
You're gonna get owned.
Don't mention Skullman, I can't take it.
I would have picked
Skullman.
I would also have picked Skullman.
So, Halloween is coming up. Are you going to be with little boys in the skull suites? Oh, it's
Are you,
again.
Did you die?
Yes.
You have 2 eyes, you son of a bitch. And you die.
This is bullshit. We might have to
We're not redoing
this footage.
This may wind up becoming a very good meme. You have 2 eyes!
I'm at the gate.
How did you die?
I'm at the gate.
We had no practice as a rule.
By the way, it hurts to smile, so don't make me laugh. Stop it.
This can be a problem.
So, I remember you have to shoot him with the charged buster 3 times, then he never does the flash stopper, right?
Bullshit.
Oh. He did the flash stopper!
Flash!
Oh. 2 hits and he's should be. I did it! I beat the stage!
The bullshit you did.
I did. I have evidence of it.
Bullshit.
I beat you in Pride Man with one eye.
I didn't realize Felon had put my number in his phone.
We need a tiebreaker, if anything. I leave that up to you with guys.
Tiebreaker your ass.
Tiebreaker drill, man.
Yeah, we'll just, we can vote on the tiebreaker.
Yeah, what's
cool? Nice try, Jeremy. Nice try.
I'm sitting in the stage, elect, waiting for the two-eyed man to beat the
stage.
I'm
still waiting for Casey to look at his phone.
It's 3-1, guys.
What level? Pharaoh?
I went. Yeah.
I'm going now. Okay, fine. You can take your advantage. You're gonna die anyway.
The NES advantage.
Ooh. You can control the Statue of Liberty.
Guys, it's Shika Roxen. He quits on everything.
I've never seen him quit.
That's true, actually.
I once saw a dream where he quit. And that also quit my dream.
That's kind of scary that you were dreaming about Shika Roxen.
Yeah.
I have had worse incidents.
I don't
like
want
what?
To know, but I'm going to ask anyway for the audience. Pants on or off?
I have one.
I don't want to answer this, actually.
Actually, now I know why Nico can only see with one eye now.
Suddenly it's all so clear.
Mm-hmm. I got the balloon adapter.
I did not.
Nice, I'm gonna go ahead. But you did take a 5-second advantage there. You should be good. Right? Right? You'll be fired if you lose again.
I mean, do I get to be the new Shika Roxen?
It hurts to look at this game, but I'm winning.
I died.
Oh.
What was that?
I'm feeling good.
It sounded like it felt good, whatever it was. Mm-hmm.
Checkpoint.
I can't do this.
Why is that?
Oh, I died again.
Why are you losing, Shika Roxen? Why are you losing?
Because this is late night.
I thought this was your
we
game.
Should do this in the morning.
This is my
this
game.
Your game.
I will edit the footage to match how I see the game.
Oh my god, I'm done.
Did you game over?
Yes.
I'm at the gate. So...
Best out of three?
No.
Best out of three?
With that performance, even three stages wouldn't cut it for you.
Well, at least we know we won't have to worry about a tiebreaker then.
I'm gonna do Pharaoh Man perfect here. Shut up. Except with, I took a hit, and I used the charge blaster, and he raped me. But otherwise...
You can have all that.
Please.
Especially with the rape.
Oh. Two more hits? No, one more hit. He's down, I win the challenge. Excellent. Good job, Shika Roxen. Jesus.
Yeah, don't issue a challenge which you can't complete.
I think I issued it first, but... Whatever.
How's it feel, Shika Roxen? How's it feel?
Stay tuned next week when Shika Roxen challenges Nico to a drinking contest.
He quits after the first shot. Oh, I can't take it.
Hey, Nico, say question.
Question to return.
Whatever that means. Hello, everybody. This is Candy Bars from the Miniboss Mafia, and I am here today with our very first interview with the members of Snupster. We have Nico, Felon, Shika Roxen, and Ultima Mantoid. I'll do it in whatever order.
Hi, guys.
Hello.
That's why you blew out. My phone up and wanted me inside you. I see it.
This is not part of my contract.
We tore up your contract. You have
and,
none.
I'm also a substitute for the Snupster group. I'm their cheap, dirty little whore to do with as they please. And
which is why he wants me inside him.
You signed the contract.
I don't remember there being a contract. But
you were heavily dosed.
Sleep. Yep, you did it when you're sleep heavily intoxicated.
Yes.
And drugged up.
I have it on my... It's actually here. Out on my shelf here.
So yes, Nico has a video of this. He'll post that later on. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so let's get down to business with our first question. How's everybody doing today?
Fantastic.
Great, I'm actually awake now.
How's this a question? This is multiple choice.
Yes.
I just woke up 30 minutes prior, no coffee, and I want to pee.
No, I want coffee.
No, don't do it! Shika Roxen! No!
So let's start off with a real basic question. Nico, why don't you tell us a little bit about how Snupster got started?
Well, I hate to admit it, it's partly because of Shikarox, and it's pretty much got kicked off at the moment when Shika and Ultima and me started hanging out together in the interwebs, and I just happened to make it official by launching Snupster.com. So you can blame me for Snupster, but I blame Shikarox for finding me on YouTube. I can't even recall what video he saw.
Initially, I was actually searching for a Guardian Legend video.
Oh, right.
And that's how I got in touch with his retro job projects. He started the Minman Challenge.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it was before I started it, you found me.
Yeah.
So you were looking for a Guardian Legend. I remember you doing the Let's Play of Guardian Legend, but you were looking for somebody else doing a video?
Yes.
Oh, it's actually one of the best games I've ever played.
My Let's Play, I think, was uploaded afterwards. At the moment, I just searched for it on a whim, I suppose, just to see how many people actually know about it. Which is surprisingly not that many, sadly.
No.
It's one of the most underrated games ever.
It is.
But apparently it didn't do this Finnish channel.
Spanish.
American Finnish channel, I don't know what.
Get it right.
So you had a giant glass of disappointment when you found
and
out
that's
that
we got hooked, I guess.
Not do the Guardian
Legend. I kept following, that sounded very odd, I regret it.
Alright, well, Nico, tell me a little bit about the name, Snupster. Where did the name come from?
You probably want the truth and nothing but the truth.
Ideally.
Yes.
So we'll take a well-constructed lie.
Okay, so originally I already bought snupster.com, the domain, and it was meant to be a placeholder for my personal stuff, and it was meant to become a service of sorts, but that project died. It was pretty much dead already, and then at Snupster we had no place to advertise ourselves or put any of our stuff in, so I claimed snupster.com for us. Didn't even think about it. So now we are Snupsters because of this.
Rest, as they say, is history.
Yep.
The name itself really doesn't mean anything particular. It was just like a random word that you chose.
No, it didn't. I didn't know it means anything, but apparently, if you search for a snup, it means an F-bomb.
Ah!
I don't know according to who, but the internet is never wrong.
That's right.
Never. Why would anybody lie on the internet?
No, so we are the F-bombers.
Okay.
Like it or not.
Okay, so we're going to open things up a little bit, and we're going to start with some of the others since you and Chica Rocks have already talked, but Ultima, you've got a pretty extensive list of games that you've played on your own, I'm guessing many before you got involved with Snupster. Tell me a little bit about how you got your start doing your videos online, some of the videos you've done, and what was your inspiration for that?
Well, the inspiration for me getting started, honestly, what sparked it was Roll Mithril's videos. I just kind of stumbled on his channel one day, and it seemed like it was a lot of fun to start doing, just, you know, recording videos and posting them up. Mm-hmm. But I'd actually been wanting to do it longer than I had been watching Roll Mithril's videos. It actually dates back to doing my Doom speedruns.
Mm-hmm.
And this was back probably like 2005, 2006, and I was like, I wish I could figure out a way to get these, you know, these runs into like a video format that was actually visible for people to watch. And it's something that I'd wanted to do for years. And then I guess, you know, like I said, the actual nail in the coffin of the idea, so to speak, to get it going was nail in the coffin, that's a really bad analogy, but anyway, yeah, the actual motivating
that's a pretty good
factor
metaphor for how things have been for us.
That last nail to the coffin.
But I guess what really sparked getting everything going was definitely Royal Mithril's videos, maybe one or two others I can't remember right now, getting, you know, really into watching. So from there, you know, I finally figured out, hey, I have the capability of doing this. I can actually start posting these speedruns. And I wanted to wait until I had a bit of a better way of doing things before posting them up. If you go on my channel and actually watch, like, the first one I posted up, it has a different quality to it than some of the stuff I'd been putting out to that point. so I wanted to wait until things were... That, I guess that's where I started, you know, going into my videos and stuff, so...
Okay, okay. All right, so Felon, tell us a little bit about how you got started doing your videos and what brought you to Snupster.
It started with Rome Mithril doing his videos, and I thought, hey, you know, I could do his stuff too. So I originally posted commentary-less videos on my channel, doing the same channel search challenge that he was doing. So that was no damage runs, you know, without the no-miss rule.
Right.
And I got up to Mega Man 6. I actually did record Windman, but then I just stopped. I guess I lost interest at that point, or I'm like, eh, you know, whatever. As a result, then my channel basically went on into hibernation for a while, and then I got a message, believe it or not, from Shika Roxen saying, thanks, mate, for your Bubble Man strategy. And I'm like, okay. And I checked his video channel out, and I'm like, oh, no miss challenge. And through him, I found Nico. So I started subscribing to them.
Oh.
And of course, through that, I found Ultima Mantoid. And that's pretty much the discovery of you guys.
All the things we share, I did not know that. That's funny.
Yeah, there you go.
Either I'm the reason we have a fucking Canadian on our team. I swear to God.
He apologizes profusely, guys. Wait, you can't apologize. He's not Canadian.
So it really sounds like Roa Mithril was the one that was the big inspiration for all of you guys to be doing this.
Yep. Kudos to him. So, I would have never probably started the challenge without his videos.
So I'm sorry, continue, Felon, about getting involved with Snupster.
Well, it basically ended up being that they started doing the races, the Mega Man 2 race with Ultimate Mantoid, and the Mega Man 1 race shortly after. And it was at that point I actually decided to contact all three of them simultaneously and say, hey, I decided to take up your challenge. And that's when I posted my first video, and I got an immediate response from... Shika Roxen, almost like he sits on his computer waiting for emails. shortly afterwards, I got a message from Nico, and then I'm like, why is Ultima Mantoid taking a very long time to reply to me? And finally got a message from Ultima Mantoid.
Now we know why he always takes such a long time. He's a Mantis.
I had to figure out how to use the computer with the little pincers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'd like to see you type.
And at that point, they were getting ready to do a Mega Man 4 race. They did one race, but somebody's race recording crashed. And they got me in for the next follow-up makeup race. And that's
for our viewers, you'll soon find out that that's actually a recurring theme, that his video crashed the first time, and the very first race I participated in, my recording was like 2 seconds long. Turns out when I thought I was recording, I actually was not. So, and I actually did, I think, remotely okay on that race, if I remember correctly.
I think you won.
No, I don't think I won.
No, it was the Mega Man 2 race. Everything allowed, and I think you did win.
Maybe I did, I don't remember. Anyway.
Because we make jokes about it. Mm-hmm. You winning a race that didn't even air.
We need to edit something in here as a proof to that statement. Make it happen.
Mm. Yeah, we'll just get his destroyed footage. It's gonna be all okay.
I believe it's actually in the episode of Sheik Roxen Doesn't Get It.
Yeah.
Yes, that might be it. I don't remember. Nico, tell us a bit about how you got started with your retro job stuff and what led you to want to race with these guys.
The retro job. It was mainly because of James Rolfe, I guess. I just... wanted to do the same thing, but with my own style. I haven't done so many retro jobs lately anymore because I think I'm better at doing challenges than reviews. Maybe? I did the Action 52 because I got my ass handed to me in Batman.
And what led you to want to race with these guys?
I don't think I ever said I want to race with these guys. It just happened. We were like, what do we want to do together? Probably race. We tried it for Mega Man 2, the first race. It seemed to go okay. It was fun. Just kept doing it. Things just happened. I can't remember if I Whose idea was it to race Mega Man? Was it my idea or Shikroxen's or Ultima's idea?
I honestly don't.
I don't believe it was mine.
Then it was my idea. And
it was my ideas. I wasn't around, but it was my idea.
And we've done like, what, 30 different races, at least on different games.
Something like that. It's gotten to be a pretty extensive library now. All right, Shika, let's tell us about the history of your videos and what else you've done besides the Mega Man stuff.
Is this going to put me in a legal bind, or...?
You know, we're in an environment where you just shouldn't have to ask those kinds of questions before you answer.
How many dead prostitutes?
Just one candy bars. It's going to end up dead.
Actually, the No Miss Cutman was my first video, so I didn't start with it till after I got hooked on with Nico's channel.
So your Mega Man were the first ones?
Indeed. Sometime after one or two was done, I believe I did the Guardian Legend Let's Play.
I think I remember, I think I helped you a bit with the videos, if I recall correctly. You did ask some help on softwares and whatnot.
Yes, as it was my first YouTube upload, I naturally didn't have everything set in stone. That was in the olden days, when I used my headset mic, which was amazing for its time.
I also had a terrible mic on my first Case Mega Man videos, and a terrible aspect ratio, but enough of that.
Okay.
We all learned.
Ratios.
I remember you bitching about the aspect ratio, like, on each one of my videos, that fucking aspect ratio. But I did finally,
I was the only one here.
I actually missed that, because it was like, it had its own unique appeal, because it was so distorted, but the commentary was so great, I couldn't stop watching them.
Alright, well, for my own part, when I first started Miniboss Mafia, and I decided I wanted to be able to interview other groups that worked on YouTube, I find these Snupster guys, and I'm like, hey, what's this all about? I'd actually been a subscriber of Nico's for a little while before that. I'd subscribed to Retro Job for probably 6 months or so before I decided to put the Miniboss Mafia group, and I'd followed Nico's stuff, and I think I'd left feedback on one or two of his videos, and I think Nico even actually responded. I don't remember. I do apologize to the guys, but I didn't know about any of you before Nico and Snupster. In fact, it was through Snupster that I found out about the other three.
You mother of a...
So I guess where we can blame Shika Roxen for the Canadian being on the team, you can blame Nico for the second American being on the team.
Second American?
Stealing my country.
Stealing
which, like anything else, it just goes to show the Americans are taking over. So
stealing my country.
And I originally was just going to do an interview. I sent a message to Nico, where I was going to interview the group, just, so for our first podcast. And I think somewhere along the way, I got invited to join a race, just to see what it was all about, which I wanted to sit in on a race anyway, so I could have something to talk about. And the next thing I know, I was invited to do more races and hang out more. And like, we like having you here, you want to stick around, and well, here I am.
Mm-hmm. Unrelated, that's how, when my points started to take a hit on season 2.
We found the right man for the job, Candy Boys.
Yeah.
There was some strategy involved there.
Yeah, without you sabotaging Sheik Roxen's run, I don't think I would run the... oops, spoilers. Oh, shut up.
Now that season 2 is done, you're fired.
And for my own part, I decided, that if I'm going to, stick around and be a part of this group, I should really, dive more into what it's all about. So I just recently started my own Mega Man Perfect No Miss Challenges, and I've got...
I like your No Perfect.
I'm pretty good at the No Perfect.
No Perfect, 100 misses.
So I've got 2 down, and I've got way, way more to go. I don't really have the time to sink into it that they do, so I don't know that I'll ever finish, but I'm never going to stop trying. But it was a lot of fun. So for my own part, that was my involvement of how I got involved with these guys. Let's talk for a minute about these perfect runs. Nico, what when you sit down to do a perfect run, what, you know, type of effort goes into to doing this? How long, what's the quickest run you've done, and what's the longest run you've done? Which one did you finish the quickest? Which one did you took you the longest? And just talk a little bit about your preparation and planning that goes into that.
The quickest? I think it was Dive Man. I think I did my first attempt. I was just gonna practice the stage. I had my mic all fucked up. It was like completely reversed. I had my elbows on the table, knocking the table, and I'm like, let's see what this stage is all about, since I think Shikaroxen did it in, what, two or three tries? And I'm like, let's see. Oh, accidentally killed him my first attempt. I should have, like, rerun it, because it was so ass, but it was the first impression I did on the first attempt. Why should I redo it? the longest... All of you guys probably know what the longest is. Running Shadow Man, over 4,000 attempts at this moment. I just checked out my notepad file, and it's over 4,000. Not over 9,000 yet. I honestly think Shadow Man has to be the fucking hardest boss in the classic series. I'd rather do Quick Man, like Shikaroxen said. He'd rather do Quick Man, as I recall. I just can't dodge Shadow Man's patterns.
I should probably put in there, we should probably omit Quick Man from the list, as it would probably be the majority of our longest.
Well, yeah, see, that's what I thought Nico was going to say. I thought he was going to say Quick Man, but...
No, Quick Man was about 2,000 tries, but Shadow Man is 4,000 and counting.
Somewhere around that number, too, I guess.
I don't know.
So talk a little bit about how you do your perfect videos. You just like run until you finally get it, or I mean, what's your strategy for that?
I used to do it like that. I used to just fire it from the beginning and see how far I can get and repeat. But now I actually take my time and see what the trouble spots are. I check where I miss or where I take damage and then practice those areas in particular. And then I go and do the boss separately, so I know how to kill the boss. And then I start doing the from the start to the end strategy again. That's how I do it. Anyway, I know some of these guys probably do it differently than I do.
That's actually a very similar method to what I do, or at least how I've done it so far. Shikaroxen, tell me a little about yours. I mean, what's your quickest run? What's your longest run? And talk a little bit how you prepare for your no-miss runs.
Well, it's a difficult answer, as I think I got Sparkman down on my first attempt on actual recording, but if you're taking for account the time that you put into practice, then that's going to be another variable that I... It might be Heatman, possibly. Mm. That one should have been one of the lesser practice times I used up. It's a pretty short, easy stage to move forward to.
Okay. What about your longest one?
Obviously, Quickman for me. I definitely passed a year. I don't even know if it was 2 years it took for me. As far as attempts goes, it actually really wasn't that many. About 2,000 or 2,500. But I also didn't do him every day for that extent of time. But by far the longest time. Possibly Needleman at the second place.
So how do you go about putting together your perfect runs? Do you do section by section like Nico does, or you just set out and go beginning to end? How do you do it?
Well, if someone has a blueprint of the perfect already, then I usually use that as my main source material. But if not, then that's another difficult question. Magnum 1 and some 2 bosses were already printed out, but at the time when I started to catch up to Nico and did some on my own, that was a different type of thing.
Copies me.
Yes. It's a lot of trial and error, basically. You just run through the stage as it is till you get hit or miss a shot, and you take a pause and just think, okay, how do I get past this obstacle? And at that point, I usually just save state and try different strategies, and if something works, then okay, moving on to the next trouble spot. And then it's just about trying to piece everything together, which usually takes between 6 to 25 hours.
Okay. Sounds good. Okay, Ultima, what about you?
For me, what goes into a video is, like, I do use, like, some of the other Snupster runs as a basis, but if you also notice, I can handle a couple of things, like, my own way. A perfect example is actually the Woodman video. I fought Woodman completely different from the other three. I'm sitting here, okay, I can't run under Woodman. There's absolutely no way. I just can't do it. So I had to sit there and look at another way completely on how to fight Woodman. So I basically have like a combination of a comfort zone, the way like something that's comfortable for me to do it consistently, and, you know, a couple of tricks here and there that I've picked up from the others. Just because I felt like I was in everybody's shadow where I was so far, you know, I was so far behind in the challenge, I decided to jump ahead and do Starman, who is my favorite Robot Master from Mega Man 5. I was like, okay, I want to do a Robot Master that nobody has done. So that was when I hit, Starman. And then when Mega Man Unlimited came out, I decided to take another, you know, one or two there. So that was when I did Glue Man, who, oh my god, I...
Don't mind was, me.
Oh my god, Glue Man's hard.
And, yeah, Glue Man's not hard.
Yes.
God, no, Glue Man himself isn't. His stage is, god. Fucking platypressers. Anyway, so I did Glue Man and Rainbow Man, and I figured Rainbow Man would be a good one to show off, because everybody's like, Rainbow Man's gonna be a 10, and I'm like, no, Rainbow Man's really not gonna be a 10. So that kind of gave me motivation to actually beat him and give him the 4, and I need to go back and redo him since they edited his stage. And then I decided, oh hey, let's do Street Fighter Cross Mega Man, so I did Chun-Li just to demonstrate that you can literally beat Mega Man by holding right. But as far as the longest or the shortest... Heat Man has the fewest attempts and the least amount of time put into it. Like, I did Heat Man on the first go. I was sitting down for a recording. Let's just do Heat Man. So I go through the level and I beat it the first time and I'm like, that's it? That's it? Really? That's it? So I was like, okay. I'm gonna do this level again and I'm gonna be like, okay, let's see how this goes. So I beat him a second time, all the way through, 2 times in a row, and I'm like, yeah. So I actually got mad that it took so little effort, because then I was like, well, what am I going to do for the rest of the day?
That wasn't my dying mood, exactly. I was so pissed.
I was so mad. I actually was kind of irritated that it took so little effort. As far as time from start to finish of a level, that's probably going to... I would say probably
Honorable
Flashman.
Mention.
Probably Flashman, as far as actual physical time.
Flash...
At least so far. Or maybe Gutsman, because he's got the shortest stage.
It is
out
of,
yeah, it really is like the shortest stage. The other side of the spectrum as far as longest, Quickman obviously with the most attempts, but the exception, I guess, if we don't include him for number of attempts, it would actually be Woodman. Almost 500 attempts on that one. And
fucking hot dogs.
That's, oh god, no, not just hot dogs. Woodman himself's hard too.
How many did you have on Needle Man?
I had 429 on Needle Man, as opposed to Woodman's like 480 something.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
But as far as the longest, as in from start to finish, time wise, in one run, Glue Man. Mm-hmm. That one was almost 6 minutes.
All right, well, Chris. Felon, tell us about yours.
In terms of doing actual challenges, or do you want me to go right to the longest, shortest?
Whichever you want to do. Whatever floats your boat.
Alright, well, let's get the easy ones out of the way. In terms of shortest, Heat Man by far. Like, literally first try. Second easiest, honestly, probably Crash Man. It took me a bit, but, I mean... No more than maybe 10 attempts in total to knock him out.
I hate you.
Even with the ladder glitch. As for longest, yes, definitely Quickman in terms of attempts, but omitting him would definitely be Needleman. I literally played every day for 3 weeks straight, probably close to 4 or 5 hours a day before I finally took him down. I was that determined to kick that prick in the butt.
You kind of need the right special pattern. I got lucky on Needle Man. It's just partly luck.
I got him twice. One of them.
It's not really luck so much as you really have to be sort of in the... I think the best way to put it is in the zone.
Hmm.
Where you're fighting him and you just got these reflexes and you're like, oh yeah, oh okay, dodge, oh yeah, okay. Right? And you don't usually...
On the other hand, you gotta admit I had an easy pattern. He just kept headbutting the same corner.
Now, if you actually watched my first with the no miss, though actually I took the video down. Stupid copyright notices and shit like that. I've got tired of that. But
those are going away, by the way.
You can't contest those under fair use rights.
No, because there was a company that was just flat out saying, no, you can't contest it. Actually, there was three of them, and apparently all of those copyrights are now being lifted, which is really weird. Like, it's suddenly, oh, hey, we've got all this copyright, and then if you try to contest it, they're like, no, we still have copyright, because they knew that a lot of people wouldn't actually, you know, go to the links to contest it through YouTube's policies, and... So now apparently it's all being reversed, and I have no idea why, because the three companies that were contesting it actually had the legal grounds to, you know, say that they did have the copyright permissions through another company that had the copyright permissions, which was from Capcom. So it's basically a big complicated web of, oh, hey, I've got permissions because this company has permissions because this company said that this company had permissions.
They're getting
so
tied up in
their own
bullshit.
It's basically been bullshit. And now they're basically disappearing, and I couldn't tell you why, and I'm wondering if it has something to do with maybe that they were abusing said copyrights and Capcom didn't like it.
Yeah,
I don't know, but I had one of mine, actually interesting story about that. Galaxy Man got banned in Canada for some reason. So I contested the copyright, and in that temporary ban got lifted. And I, of course, messaged him like, why is this banned in Canada and Germany? So one of them basically lifted the copyright, and the one that I knew wouldn't lift it actually reinstated just the other day. So, yeah, there's that one particular company is still being a dick about it. However, it's not banned in Canada anymore, so they have fixed that part.
It's enough for me that they ban in any countries. That's horseshit.
Yep. They was also
really
banned from mobile for a while, too. I couldn't even watch my own runs from mobile. I was actually kind of pissed about that.
At that point when they ban it in your own country, you can't watch your own videos, you know something is fucked up.
Pretty ridiculous.
Well, no, because it was in regards to my Needleman video that I deleted because I just got tired of the copyright shit. In my original Needleman video, I actually got Needleman stuck in a pattern where he's jumping, just doing the high needle every time, and I just killed him that way, like half health, and 14 shots later, and he died. I knew that was going to happen when I actually did the real run. So I actually had to learn to do the fight. The way I did the fight, and it looks very scary to be up close and personal to him, but it is honestly the safest way to deal with the no-miss rule against him. As for how I do my videos, I do it very similar to everyone else in the sense that I'll go through the stage and find the trouble spots and start practicing them. However, that's sort of changed lately, and yes, that was my phone. Is that you again?
No. That was not me.
Okay. Where was it? Oh, yeah. So what I've done lately, if you notice, since I started doing the Mega Man killers, is I've started speedrunning the stages. And the reason I've started speedrunning the stages is just kind of push myself to the limit. Because sometimes some stages are actually easier if you just speedrun it. I don't know if you ever noticed certain sections, but if you keep holding in like one direction, nothing ever hits you, and you're like, wow, okay, so I just need to keep doing that instead of actually fight the challenge, you know, face on. And I noticed that a lot of the later games, like Mega Man 9, Mega Man 10, are actually designed that way, like where the, it looks like you're going to get hit, but you don't, as long as you hold to the extremities in one direction or something. Sort of like Chun-Li's video. So I started looking for those kind of things in each of the stages. You know, where can I hold in one direction? You know, if I shoot at this particular mark on the screen, can I hit that enemy that's about to spawn on screen before I have to actually deal with him? Kind of like that kind of stuff. So I started changing my strategy in a sense that way to kind of just sort of turn it into a clockwork run, I guess is the best way I can put it.
Okay.
Where everything just lands into place and then you just deal with the pieces as you need to deal with the pieces.
Honestly, though, it seems like every one of us have their own strategies. Except me. I just wing it. Stuff happens, I laugh. And suddenly I beat the stage. And then Ultima is like, he's so slow that it's fun to watch. It's like what he's gonna do next. He's tippy-toeing and the enemy's flying like one pixel away from him. He's still standing there. Should I move or not? And he does perfect. It's so fun to watch.
Yeah, I have a lot of hesitation, and I think part of that is I try to give every run, like, the effort, you know, like, okay, I can do this, and I don't want to mess those runs up, because to me, it's, I never know if that's going to be the run, so you'll see a lot of hesitation in some of my videos, and I'm just like, should I go? Okay, hang on, wait, should, no, wait.
The funny thing about this, when you have, like, 20 minutes of outtakes, you're still at the same spot after 20 minutes. And
you realize you're still in attempt number one.
that's usually when I start laughing, when you're at the same spot for 20 minutes, dying and dying and dying over again, and you're like, shit, that happened again.
Oh, you mean how I crammed like 45 outtakes into 30 seconds on Needleman?
Yeah, like that, yeah.
Because all you hear is poof, poof.
Yeah, just the idea of you running a stage for that long.
A line comes into my head, and I believe it was, I hate these things.
I hate these things.
I hate these things.
Cough, plagiarist, cough.
I have no idea. I thought it was homage, honestly.
I'm just kidding. Yes, it was.
My own videos are very much a lot like that. A lot like Ultima's in the sense that I never seem to know if this is going to be the run or not, so I tend to be a little more cautious in my efforts. I think I could have done, I know I could have done my Iceman run a lot quicker if I had tried to push the issue, but I was still so new at it, and I wanted, you know, it done so well, I just wanted to make sure that that was going to be the one. So I, and the thing was, is like a week before, actually it wasn't even a week before, it was a couple days before, I was still working on Iceman. Dylan was trying to, you know, help push me to stay in it and get it done, and he had gone back through and had redone Iceman. He'd done it really fast. What was your time on that, Felon? Do you remember?
I don't recall what it was. I think it was just over 3 minutes with the kill.
Actually, I think it was just under 3 minutes, because my video is right around 3 minutes.
Yeah, I've noticed that most stages and boss kills are in the 3 minute mark, and that seems to be sort of, I guess, Capcom's trademark stage boss design.
Cutsman.
Well,
there are a couple of exceptions. On the other end of the spectrum, there's a couple of exceptions.
Crashman.
Like, yeah, Crashman and Electman, because they have mostly vertical stages.
It's mostly due to screen scrolling and, yeah, vertical stages.
Yeah, ladder climbing is so damn slow in Mega Man 1.
Yes, it is. But for my own part, I kind of pick and choose from like Nico's philosophy, and then also I just kind of tend to plow through things, but I'll like take a stage and I'll break it down section by section, and I'll work it in small sections until I've got it right, and then I'll go back and I'll piece them together.
I still get angry letters because of my Concrete Man and Flash Man runs.
Yeah, it's calm.
Why do you get angry letters?
Shikroxen will explain.
I've only got two runs to draw from, so my short run was obviously my Cutman run, and I did Cutman in, I think, just over 2 hours.
Cutman ran you?
What?
Did you say Cutman ran you?
He's only got two videos down, so as short as his Cutman, as long as his Iceman.
Cutman I did in just over 2 hours. Iceman took 5 days, 5 long days. And I know that's just the tip of the iceberg for what's coming later. But
welcome to the pages.
Yeah.
I got most of Mega Man 1 in 5 days.
Yes, you did. I remember you plowing through Mega Man 1 so fast. I was like, oh,
fast too.
Like yeah. Your mother. I mean...
Oh.
All right, so let's take things back a little further. We're all retro gamers here. What, Nico, what got you started as a gamer? What was your earliest gaming memory? What were your first games?
I think I was about 4 years old, and just one day my parents got me the Japanese Famicom. I don't recall where from, but the thing was broken somehow. It had the adapter. I don't know what was wrong with it, but I remember popping in Super Mario 2 and the graphics were all messed up. So I had to wait for another like 2 weeks, and we got the European NES, the good old gray box. And my first ever game was Super Mario 2, and that's still one of my favorite games. But I also had Mega Man 4, which I remember I did complete it like when I was like 5, and I remember that was one of the hardest things I've ever done in video game history. And that's probably why I can beat it one-eyed. But yeah, that was, I was 4, had the NES, had good games, Lolo, Mario, Mega Man. I didn't have any Zeldas though, and I still haven't beaten Zelda 1. I haven't played more of it than 1 minute. I've gotten the sword and power off. So you may see a let's play of Zelda 1 on the NES on my channel at some point. But that is my earliest memory of video gaming.
Alright, Shika Roxen, what about you?
Earliest game memory.
Game, not gay. We don't want to know about your game memories.
Sorry.
Well, 2 weeks ago, I was with this one guy.
I remember... Like, he's my first console definitely was NES, and... Naturally, I also believe Super Mario Brothers was the first game. And or Duck Hunt. Because I think that one was included
the
in
duck
the European Hell version.
Did you know that...
Meanwhile...
Did you know that you can control the ducks with the second controller?
Yes.
No,
yes.
Actually,
like,
I didn't know
about it. Like, it's supposed to be a two-player game, from what I've heard.
But
it was not advertised as such, but yes, you can control the ducks.
Oh.
I also have very early memories of the Game Boy I had up on very early on, and I also were introduced, in general, for Nintendo 64 and PlayStation along the same time here, too, even though I didn't own them at the time, but... Like, I did not get the NES till maybe 96 or something, so all of the consoles were released by then.
I remember I got it in 92. It was pretty late as well, but I think they released the NES in the Europe quite
late.
Yeah,
they were pretty late with it.
Yeah.
Wow, I'm gonna feel bad discussing my earliest memories.
And, I'd like to, yeah.
My neighbor also had the SNES, so like I was surrounded with everyone playing everything, because it really was the time and era of doing so. Like, video games had taken a tremendous leap since the Atari 2600 or the 7200 or what have you.
I'd like to add also, when I got my first PC, one of the first games I ever played was Duke Nukem 3D. I was 7.
That is a good game.
Duke Nukem, that was a good game.
I remember I was a bit scared of the game, but I did like it.
Yeah, it's pretty dark.
Yeah.
Bubble was the only game I ever beat on the actual console as a kid.
No. I always wanted Bubble, but I never got it.
I have nightmares about that music.
Dude, Bubble is one of the best NES games. But it has the same goddamn music play for 2 hours.
Because I know Felon, I think, is about the same age I am. Felon, let's hear about your earliest gaming memories.
Oh, wow. I thought you would go first, and then I would go off you.
Amiga 500.
Well, I can.
Well, okay. Let's try to do this as a duo.
Okay.
Commodore VIC-20.
See, you started out as a computer guy. My first earliest memories were the Atari 2600. We went through a pair of Atari 2600s before I ever saw my first Nintendo.
Sorry that I interrupt, but have you guys heard of the Amstrad CPC 464 or something? I also had that.
I actually haven't heard about that.
Well, that was was more of a European gaming computer. I don't think it was very popular in the United States.
Probably.
Hmm.
Right on, my first video game memories on Atari, we played a lot of Pac-Man. I remember Pitfall 2 was the very first game I ever played that actually had an ending to it. That was something new to me at that point.
Didn't Nintendo make another Pitfall game that was awful?
It was horrible. It was absolutely terrible.
Yeah.
And there was a super athletic game called Decathlon where you basically just beat the joystick back and forth, and that's how you made your character run, and it was really, really annoying. But yes, I had my first Nintendo in the spring of 1987, and one of the first games I got was this little game from a company called Capcom called Mega Man. Of course, we all know that's never going to go anywhere, but it was a really awesome game. I loved it. It was that and Rad Racer.
Who the fuck plays Mega
games.
Man?
Yeah, right. I know.
I don't know.
I've never even heard of it.
Mega Man and Rad Racer were my first
games. Rad Racer. I could never finish it. Yeah. But I remember accidentally pressing the down button because it changes the track. And then I was like, shit, I've done it again. I accidentally just pressed it every time I turned. Shuffled through the music on every turn.
Select button, which was supposed to simulate 3D, or am I wrong?
Oh yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, you press select. It actually came with the 3D glasses, and they were terrible.
Wow.
I never had the 3D glasses because I bought the game from a reseller shop or something,
Nintendo for me was actually, I didn't get it early on. I knew other people with one, and we went to this sort of daycare because, you know, I was a young one at the time, and they had one, so, you know, I knew about it, but I didn't have one for probably until, I'm trying to remember if it was like a Christmas or something, but I can't remember. So I didn't have it early on, so by the time we actually got a Nintendo, a lot of the games had actually already been out. And the first Mega Man game I played was Mega Man 3, as I've answered my question before I finished my sentence. And I actually rented that from the store, and I'm like, let's see, what's this? Oh, I want to be... And funny enough, the first stage I ever played was Hard Man stage. Because I'm like, I thought it was a wrestling game where you pick like your robot wrestler. Not really. I did read the, who reads the instruction book, guys? And I'm like, who's this blue guy? So I'm going through the stage, and I never knew about Rushko at the time, so we, of course, had to kill myself and try another stage. And then I went back and I found Mega Man 1, and then later on I found Mega Man 2, which most people consider the greatest game of the Mega Man series. But for me, of course, it's Mega Man 3 because that was the first one I ever played.
Shut up, Nico. Mega Man 2 is the best one in the series.
Mega Man 4 is the best one in the series.
How about 7?
As you can see, folks, there is some debate amongst the team as to which is actually the best Mega Man.
That's why we are individuals.
And no, don't ask me to tiebreaker it because I like both of them after having played 4, you know, almost 80 freaking times just to try and catch Nico's time in some of these races here. I grew up with Mega Man 2, but, and I didn't play 4 as much as 2. Like, 2 is my childhood. Like, that is the game that epitomized my childhood on the NES. I mean, there were a lot of games that I played a lot on the NES, but I have to admit, 2 was definitely my favorite on the NES. But now that I've played 4 a lot, 4 has pretty much the same jump mechanics as 2, which are the best jump mechanics. 4 has the best slide mechanics, which they're far superior than 3's. 4 also doesn't have a faulty Mega Buster like 3 did. 4 has some of the more interesting Robot Masters, at least compared to some of the others.
And man, I remember the first time getting to Cossack stages.
And
mind blown.
I was about to mention that. 4 is the first one of the series that had a boss, like a main villain, that ended up not being the main villain.
Damn that music. So beautiful.
So it really is a toss-up between 2 and 4 as far as the best classic Mega Man series.
You're dead
technically, technically, Mega Man 3 had a mysterious villain, as Dr. Wily was working with Dr. Light in the main storyline.
But he didn't have a name.
But Mega Man 3 sucks.
But technically, Mega Man 1 had Capcom as its main villain for putting that fucking front picture on the cartridge.
That's true. That was like really horrid artwork.
That was a douche move.
Are we seriously gonna discuss the artwork?
No, no. Let's
it is a new question. Let's just edit it here.
We discuss could be here the all Mega day Man. About that.
So if Mega Man 2 is, you know, like the highlight of my childhood, but wish I could tell you what games because I honestly don't know. But they were all for the ColecoVision.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I actually used to play the ColecoVision. I'm 29. I'll be 30 next year.
Okay, so yeah, you were around a little bit when those were still kind of available. Okay.
Yeah, it's Nico and Shika Roxon, which are the youngins.
Yeah, the baby.
See, my uncle also had a Commodore 64. So when I was playing ColecoVision, I would play the NES, and I would play the Commodore 64 and the NES when I was at my uncle's. So on like the Commodore, we had stuff like, and I want to do a Let's Play of this game if I can find a Commodore 64 emulator, because it sticks out as a childhood memory. But there was a game for the Commodore called Night Games, and it was basically a collection of mini games. You could pick like quarterstaff fighting or archery or sword fighting, and it was basically just various things that you could do that were related to like the medieval knight days, and it was so fun, and I miss that game so much. I really do. It was great. As far as other games though that I played a lot of, let's see, I played a lot of Mega Man, I played a lot of Kickle Cubicle, I owned Ooh. Batman, Lolo. See, what else did I play?
It's amazing that you played Kickle Cubicle. That's
dude,
one of the rare games.
I love Kickle Cubicle. Yeah. I own it. It's great.
It is. In my opinion, it's better than Lolo.
There is something, though, and I think I may be able to pull the wool on everybody here. Has anybody heard of a Socrates?
Nope.
A Socrates?
A Socrates. It was like an educational video game system.
Oh, yes. Actually, now that you mention that, I do seem to remember.
It had that robot that looked like Rob,
yes,
kind of.
I do
and
remember that.
It had these little cartridges. Like, everything, it was really cool. Like, I do have some fond memories of it. It was kind of like an educational point of view for like the NES or the Atari or the ColecoVision. I mean, the graphics weren't great, they weren't stellar, they were basic, but everything was meant for like child development. Like, they had one thing, it was like a little keyboard, like a music keyboard that you could hit the notes on and try and make your own music. Of course, I'm not musically inclined when it comes to making stuff. I'd probably do better now, but and then they had like, you know, you could make the shapes. Like, they'd give you a square, and you had to make a square with a little touchpad that had a pen. So, ooh. I mean, it had some cool gear under the hood for its day. And yeah, I thought that was, you know, thinking back on it, that's actually really neat. They put a lot
of... Educational game, cough number munchers.
No, this was an educational console. Like, it wasn't just a game. It was a console, and you had various things you could plug into it. So, I wish I could remember who developed it.
Shika Roxon, keep it in your pants.
Yes, please.
I was a pulse. You could actually probably find this, I'm sure you could probably go on eBay and find one of those if you really wanted to. I'd find anything on
price
there.
Price must be up the roof.
I do want to add this, though. As much as I grew up with console gaming, I'm actually not a first-generation gamer. My mother was a big arcade gamer when she was in school, and even when I was a little baby, and to this day... My mother is in her late 50s. If you stick her in front of a Galaga arcade machine, she will destroy it. She is wicked.
Is she going to do the Mega Man challenge?
The same way with Pac-Man and, I believe, Missile Command. So...
God,
my mom still has problems jumping over the first Goomba Mario Brothers.
Some of us have come further than others, it would seem. Okay, moving on. Let's discuss what each Snupster's doing now besides the different races that we do as a team. Nico, are you doing anything besides the Snupster stuff right now? Any other Let's Plays in the mix or anything else?
Well, I lately challenged all the Snupsters to do a speed run of Mega Man 1 without Buster only. I like to keep doing challenges on my channel. Some of them are more crazy than I anticipate, but...
You've definitely kind of made a migration from a let's play kind of guy to more of a let's find crazy challenges and do videos about that.
Yeah,
sort of thing.
I'm about over the let's play things. And
speaking
I'm more about
challenging.
Yep.
Yeah, speaking of challenge, I did issue Nico the first challenge. Only to give him a taste of what it's like to run a stage the way I run the stages. And I do have to say congratulations on beating my challenge.
Oh, you're talking about the Cutman speedrun.
Cutman speedrun.
I tried that one myself.
Yeah. That was fun. Although, I'm sorry for beating you.
I don't feel bad, I've already beaten that time.
I haven't seen anything up.
What about you? Do you have anything else going on besides the Snupster videos?
When I feel up for starting to edit again, only God knows when, I do have a couple of perfects all
Hello,
done.
God.
So, the idea right now is just to try and put up everything, and hopefully we'll see something going out before Christmas, because I got almost dozens of them lying on my desktop that needs editing and this get released. I have a couple of ideas for the future, but it's either issues with hardware or either in some ways of how to run them or how to record them. I would love to fiddle around with the PlayStation Portable, but I have yet to find a solution for it. The DS could be one fun thing to do, and I even had some plans for PlayStation 2 at some point. So we'll see what I decide upon. These days, a lot of videos already exist also, so I don't want to be one of those 500 people doing the same thing all over.
Yeah, that's what's stopping me as well. There's too many people doing like the same games over and over and over again. That's why I tried to find something else that haven't been done so much to did.
That has kind of exploded, I think, here in the past couple of years. We're just all of a sudden, oh, hey, these guys are playing games. I can do it too. And all of a sudden, next thing you know, you've got 30 guys doing speedruns of Super Mario Brothers.
But I'd like to point out our challenge is still pretty unique.
Yep.
It is.
Indeed. So it's going to be a balance between challenges and let's plays or whatnot. I just need to decide on something, I guess. And find some time. And whenever I feel up for it, I guess.
So lots to look forward to from Shigaroxen in the months to come.
Swedish subtitles might be included at some point.
I like
that
ending.
Awesome.
After all that.
That would be awesome. Ultima, what about you? You got anything in the pipeline?
What don't I have in the pipeline?
That's the worst question to ask this guy.
His pipes are full.
Do you really want me to answer that question?
Yeah. Right. Ultima, keep this down to 1 minute, please.
Alright. I'll do my best.
Okay.
Time's up.
So, I'm wanting to pick up doing the fighting game videos, but I haven't had the time or money or effort to pick up Ultra Street Fighter 4. I do have a couple more Skullgirls videos I need to post up. I still have to finish the Solo White Mage Challenge, which has been on hiatus for a year due to the Year of Doom that I've been working on, which if anybody has visited my channel, you notice that 90% of the content over the last year has been Doom.
Doom.
Well, Doom had its 20th anniversary. I had to do something. That's what I got known for.
Gotta love the guy.
I'm trying to branch out from there. Let's see. I need to finish Earthbound. Wait for it. You hear that? That's the amount of people that care. Anyway.
I watched an episode of it.
I do need to finish Earthbound. Because that one's been on hold for like 3 years. it's not been forgotten, I promise.
Case Nintendo World
I hope
Cup
will satisfy everybody. I have to finish Amnesia Machine for Pigs. I need to get back to doing videos for the Let's Plays. I need to make another Galsteam video at some point because I love Galsteam as a meme.
So, from Ultima Mantoid.
Hoping, on top of all of this, I've still got to doing more with the Twitch channel that I've been trying to stream on. I've been doing stuff with the Railgun Rangers and WikiDoo, and every Sunday night and Monday Made me say Monday might, not Monday night. Thanks, Phelan. Anyways, every Sunday night and Monday night, we usually do a stream, unless something happens and we just end up canceling. But so there's always that. And I'm starting, it's actually going to start tonight at some point, speedrun Saturdays. So on my channel, on Twitch, I'll be starting a night basically where I get a couple games that I'm familiar with and I've played a lot, and I'll probably try to just speedrun them. Probably a lot of Mega Man titles. Doom will probably be in there. Metal Combat, Battle Clash, Monster Party. Just a couple games I want to learn how to do on an actual speedrun going on right now. There's probably a couple of other things I haven't mentioned, but I have a lot going on, so...
You have a busy career in YouTube.
Sleep? I don't know what the sleep thing is.
This guy never sleeps.
Keep an eye on Ultima Mantoid's channel the next several months. Sounds like he's going to have a lot going on. Felon, what
ask,
about you?
Yeah, ask Nico. I don't sleep. It's like, are you in bed yet? Yeah, I've got to be working 3 hours. I'm going to bed.
Until you don't go.
To go to bed.
Yeah, you always say, I'm going to bed now. Then after 1 hour, I message you. I'm still here.
In terms of challenges, I'd like to finish off the main franchise for the Mega Man challenges and then move on to... There has been thought about doing a swordless, or not swordless, that would be great, wouldn't it? A sword only Ninja Gaiden challenge of the first three games.
Swordless Ninja Gaiden.
Swordless Ninja Gaiden, right? Is that even? Wow.
Yeah. Swordless challenge, but I still have to look into some of the more, how should I say it, difficult parts of the game, because as we know, all know, it's brutal.
Pretty much from beginning to end.
Yeah, which means I'm probably just going to end up breaking it down to the stage by stage to do it. And then I was thinking of doing something, because of Ultima's Doom challenges, it actually got me interested in doing my sort of spin on his Doom stuff. And that's actually Quake and Quake 2, believe it or not, for me.
Oh, okay.
When he was doing Doom, I've been playing Quake 1 and Quake 2 online.
So there's a Doom guy, a Quake guy, and Duke Nukem 3D guy.
And I'm for an unreal tournament.
And that totally reminds me, I forgot to mention that I do still have Trials of a Doom God in mind, for those that keep up with my channel.
Yeah, so I'm not sure what I want to do with the Quake series, if I just run, you know, do sort of stage runs similar to Ultima's style, because Ultima's actually said he has interest in seeing me play Quake.
On that note, I've actually had slight interest myself in starting to speedrun Doom, so we might see something about that in the future.
I would be more than happy to give you a hand and show you the ropes.
So, some interesting stuff to look for on Felon's channel then. For my own part, I'm still working on perfecting Fire Man. I actually broke it out and tried to do some last night, and I've completely regressed. I'm gonna have to start all over.
All right, so let's go back to your question. What was the longest Robomaster you've done?
Yeah, Fireman has surpassed that, but only because I don't really think I've gotten serious about it yet. And
you
that's part
are,
of the
dare I say, fine.
When you beat Iceman, that was you going to be like serious into it, because Iceman is one of the hardest ones.
Then why can't I get Fireman?
Because fire droppers are bullshit.
Yes, they are. And I cannot use Nico's method. I don't know why. I've tried it several times, but I cannot use Nico's method.
Luck.
Anyway, my goal is to try to finish the Mega Man 1 Perfects by next summer. Given the fact that I have a full-time job and a wife and several other hobbies, I think that's probably a reasonable goal for me.
Holy shit, and you're married. What?
They're slowing you down. You should get
I'll tell my wife you said that. And then,
girls before... Oh, right.
Make a man before...
Shika Roxanne doesn't know about, you know, respect and care and mutual
that's
relationships.
Right. Yeah, he's a hit it, quit it, and forget it kind of guy.
What comes to Mega Man, anyway?
It's not a retro game, but I'm anxiously awaiting the new Metal Gear. I've been a Metal Gear fan from day one. And so that's...
So you're really a fan of movies. That sometimes lets you play.
I can somewhat agree to that statement. I gave up after Sons of Liberty. No, wait, that's the...
Sons of Liberty is the last one I've played.
Guns of Patriots is the last one I played.
Guns of the Patriots was an excellent game. Oh. I have not played Peace Walker, you're denying yourself an excellent game.
It was on the shopping list some year ago.
I haven't played Metal Gear. It's solid.
Metal Gear!
I remember firing a Metal Gear on PlayStation 2, watched a cutscene for 10 minutes and shut off the console. I don't want to watch a movie, I want to play.
And that's why I'm not a big fan of Resident Evil 6. Wait, guys, hold on. I gotta keep hitting the X button. Keep hitting the X button! Okay, I got past that part.
Alright, so let's talk about something that makes Snupster unique, and I think it's certainly one of the more humorous elements of the situation, is let's talk a bit about some of the catchphrases that are so popular with Snupster.
Are we going to talk about
ketchup? And how they came to be. I know there's a section on the website where they have occasionally hosted one of these catchphrases and the origin of the catchphrase, but let's talk about some of these. Nico, you want to start?
Probably most obvious is the ketchup.
Yes.
I can't recall what...
It was MM4, actually. I looked through the industry. Yes,
that's,
it was
MM4. It had to have been, because that was where I earned the title of Comeback King.
So, someone said something about catching up, and someone heard it, ketchup?
Yeah. It was actually a comment made by Sheik Roxon, I think. No, it was... It was actually Ultima Mantroid when Sheik Roxon was actually beating Nico at Ringman. Yeah. And Ultima said, oh, don't worry, Nico has a strategy to come from behind. He'll catch up.
Oh, I remember that, yeah.
And that was the start.
I love ketchup. And also,
truth
obviously,
be told,
yeah, go ahead.
I was going to say, truth be told, I actually genuinely do love ketchup. I'll make hot dogs and just drown them.
If we're going to confess stuff, I practically lived on eggs and ketchup for a year during college. So I have somewhat getting tired of ketchup. I'm more of into mustard right now, yes. But at some point,
you know, mustard just doesn't sound good in a comment, so we stick with ketchup.
Once you try ketchup, you never go back.
Well, I suppose we're gonna have to mustard our runs now.
Mm-hmm.
Mustard.
And for some reason, after my failed Flashman, it's not a fail, but I did complete Flashman, but I did say, "Don't you fucking hit me," and he didn't. So I passed the stage, no miss perfect. As for some reason, these guys keep saying the phrase, "Don't you fucking hit me."
And then I came in, showed him there was a strategy.
Yeah, there was a strategy to Flash Man.
Yeah.
Like, what? I just went in his room, I'm like, don't you hit me? Oh, no, he didn't.
What, where there's no strategy is when you're playing Flash Man with the moonwalk on.
Oh, God! Oh!
If you don't know what we're talking about, go watch the latest Deranged, the moonwalk.
Oh, man. That was great.
Next time on Snupster, moonwalk inverted.
No.
Oh, no.
Make that.
No.
Please, God, no.
And then, of course, I've started saying, damn it, Nico, since he interrupted my Iceman recording when I was working on my Iceman outro, and he just out of nowhere pops up about the footholder glitch, and I'm like, damn it, Nico.
You've done tried to record for, like, 20 attempts. I totally forgot you were recording, and I'm like, blah, 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 blah. Oops.
And ever since then, anytime I want to blame something on him, that's what I say.
Damn it, Nico.
Didn't Chris kill you at some point when you practiced?
Yes. Nico? I was about to kill Tri Nitro Man, no miss perfect, and he messaged me on Steam.
I remember that. That's
you, like, dragged the message on screen, and you're like, I hate... Or no, I love you so much, right? Or something like that.
No, I was like two hits away
so
from killing
right now.
Him.
No, you weren't two hits away from
killing
him.
I was.
He was close, though.
He was halfway down.
But you gotta remember, you can shoot his head and he takes more damage.
Yes, this is true. You posted a message to me prior, and my computer has this really nasty habit of turning on in the middle the night or whatnot, so it actually turned itself on, and you thought I was online, so you, like, posed the question or made a statement. And then when I finally got home from work, I'm like, oh, response, nice. And that's...
that's when I was live on Twitch, trying to kill Tri-Nitro.
Okay, so were there any other big quotes that we have, or are those are pretty much the main ones?
Pudding.
Oh, my pudding. Oh, yes.
There's a lot of them.
Yeah. Pudding came out of nowhere. Yeah. I literally just said it. Like, it just happened. And I'll never be able to look at the word pudding the same way again because of it.
And you have to do it now.
I love pudding. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I said, I love pudding. And what makes it even better is I did it in the Mickey Mouse voice. It's just, I love pudding. Pudding in your ass.
That never gets old.
At least you still have your cats.
Oh, yes. That's another good one.
Oh my god.
And now, since Nico has a cat of his own, we can use it on Nico as well.
Yep.
Yes.
Well, the funny thing is that at least you still have your cat is actually just a phrase directed towards Ultima, even though he doesn't have a cat.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. It's more funny when you don't have a cat.
Because you always kept complaining about some stupid stuff like, oh, I lost 2 seconds, so I died again. Well, at least still have your cat.
I would have won had I not lost.
That's one of the best ones.
Hang on, let me go on 15 again and I'll win.
I actually watch our old episodes again, and on our third episode ever, Ultima goes like, well, had I not game over, I would have actually won. Like, no shit.
I thought it was way next.
We could actually probably do an entire podcast alone just on the catchphrases.
Yep, we can move on from this.
We could have.
The bubble boss.
So we should probably
my favorite one.
The last crab.
No, that is a good one though. That fucking last crab.
I've never seen anyone die at the bubble boss.
It gives me like memories as a child too, which is what's funny about it. But my favorite one is Nico. Us doing Mega Man 2, and he's like, I fell down in the Mega Dragon, fuck my life, and he's like, walks away.
Oh, and he gets up and walks away from the microphone.
Yeah.
I was so frustrated, because I remember, I just kept thinking, if I die, I'm last, if I die, I'm last, and then I fucking hop down.
Not to mention, I almost burned my house down, and I spit my beer during Mega Man 4.
Yep. Oh, Shika Roxon is at work learning about mandatory. How do you phrase that again, Candy?
Oh, fire safety training?
Yeah, something like that.
I like the sound effect I put in. It's like his whole fucking house is burning down.
It sounds like there's like 4 hours of fire behind it.
There's a fire in my apartment.
Ultimately, there is so many quotes that has occurred during these races. And I'm sure a lot of more recent quotes will be added from Season 3.
Yeah.
Shika Roxon, the earliest one that I remember from him, is the countdown that doesn't quite finish properly.
Oh, yeah.
2.5 men. 2. Did I hear 2.5 men?
Yes.
Do we go on one?
Yes, that's another common one.
And that was on the very first race ever.
Shit. You're never allowed to count again. You're banned from counting.
Yeah, it's become a pretty common rule that we never ever let Shika Roxon count down. It's because people never ever play.
Also, one of more famous ones is, sorry guys, my game crashed.
My recording just crashed.
Oh, and also, this is the run.
Yeah, we've been playing a lot of Risk of Rain. It's always like a hit or miss if you make the run. So we started saying, this is the run. Although this is not done on YouTube.
Also, and I quote, I've never seen it happen.
No, never seen it.
And then it usually preceded by it happening.
that was followed by a, Nico, you might get your request here. I just died at the bubble boss.
It works, like, fairly often. Like in Flame Mass, I've never seen anyone die at Flame Mass level. Then you say, stop it.
Proceed,
like, swimming in oil. You have to kill yourself.
I have to kill myself. Fuck it. Because there was no rush coil. Like I had the suicide.
I'm okay with this.
Moving on. This past summer, we did a first ever. We had the Snupster live stream.
Ooh, yeah.
About that. Nico, let's talk about some of the lessons learned in putting together a 3-day summer stream like we did.
Lesson learned, don't make a 3-day summer stream. 3 days was a bit too much, and we had too many games, and the schedule was too tight.
Well, I think it's not that it's the 3 days that's the problem. I think it's just we had way too full of a schedule, and it was absolutely killing us because I think we averaged, 4 hours of sleep a night?
Mm.
Which I'm used to that. I'm used to only getting 3 or 4 hours of sleep a night.
Yeah.
You know, it's everyone else that's not used to it. So, I mean, it really didn't faze me too much. I mean, yeah, I was a little bit drained, you know, after 3 days, but I'm used to that as well.
But honestly,
the
last game we switched the last game to Mega Man Unlimited the day before, and it was the last game of the 3 days we ever did, and I felt like I was dying. Like, seriously, I felt like I was gonna pass out or die.
For me, it was that zombie
killing floor.
Killing floor.
You went to sleep.
I'm the only one of the four of us that stayed up for the entire duration.
I stayed up, but I was almost dead.
That's what I'm saying. You finally crashed at the very, very end.
Yeah, I crashed in Mega Man Unlimited.
I went through the entire thing.
Let me point out here, Nico is the one usually landing with his so-called friends of his. I have no friends, but the point is I am not the one staying up landing. I have no idea why the one doing it is complaining.
Shika Roxen, you can consider me a friend, as long as you keep up on your monthly payments.
Now who's but it's
pimp. Only $14.99 per month, Felon can be your friend too.
But yeah, we did learn a lot from the summer stream, and I think we will have another stream at some point. Not decided yet, but we will have it more organized. Less games, better games.
Less games, better games. Definitely test out software, hardware in advance. Couple of months.
Yeah, that was one of the big things.
We learned a lot.
Emulators.
I think I was the only one that had no problems during the summer stream.
Yeah.
So organizing,
setting up things with, I don't know how long it took us to get things set up where we could Twitch everything and get it to work right. And then, because I know we started out using one program, and I guess it wouldn't work with half the games we wanted to do, so we wound up having to use a different one.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just there's a lot of technical stuff behind the scenes that people don't even think about. I mean, first of all, watching Nico put the schedule together and trying to arrange the schedule with 4 different people on basically 3 different continents.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or I guess 2 actually. But I mean, it was
2 different continents. 4 different countries.
4 different countries, 2 different continents. There's a lot of logistical work. And just, I mean, first of all, I'd like to say thanks to Nico for all the work that he put into that. Because.
No problems.
There was a lot.
That was amazing. I don't even know how you did that. If it had been me, I'd just be like, yeah, fuck this. I'm just going to go this way now.
Let's wing it.
And some of our best summer stream stuff didn't even require super technical recording. Cards of Humanity.
Oh yeah. My god.
Oh yeah, Cards of Humanity was hilarious. Worms, that was hilarious. Nico, you need to get the Worms videos up. Those are great.
I will.
I keep pressing him to do it. I've got the first episode. I've sent it to him once.
I have it on my Sony Vegas. It's
which
being
brings
edited.
Us to the next topic. Next stream, probably 12 hours a day at the most, and try to use some of the hours remaining on the days to just categorize the recordings and start rendering shit.
We need plans.
Unless we decide to do one big 24-hour stream or something.
We could be done.
One big 24. Could be done. As long
but we need, if there are breaks in 24 hours, they need to be an hour long. You need time to make food.
At every hour, we have to have the 24 toot, toot, toot. You know, it's like an intermission.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. Doot, beep.
No. From 24, the television series.
Oh, I get what you're saying now. Oh, yeah.
Never seen that.
Okay, well, definitely it was a lot of fun, but yeah, there was a lot of lessons learned and a lot of new ground for us. But I think everybody, I mean, even though it was a lot of work, I think everybody did enjoy themselves.
Yeah.
Yep.
I ended up losing like all the Mega Man games, but I had a blast.
Now let's talk a bit about the future plans for Snupster. We just wrapped up season 3.
Season 2.
No, season 2. I'm sorry. And we'll be getting a start on season 3 here pretty soon. Nico, you want to talk a bit about that?
Yeah, the only thing I'm going to say is that we start in January, I think, at this part, at this moment. It's gonna be January.
Arguably.
Yep. And I'm not gonna say much. We are releasing a trailer, and that should give you a little bit of insight. But I don't want to spoil anything just yet. It's gonna be totally different than what you've seen. And I don't think anyone in YouTube has done what we are about to do.
I was just gonna say, the idea is not to have a rehash of the same thing every season.
No. Basically, every move you make now counts. Everything you do does something to everyone else or yourself.
Every decision you make.
Yes.
It's gonna be a very exciting.
All I can say is that if you enjoy the races we're doing and if you enjoy the challenges we're doing, this is going to be for you.
Yes.
Yep. Most definitely. And we're all gonna die the Mecha Dragon walk away from the mic.
I can foresee this.
And then I'm going to walk outside and get pissed because there's trees and be reminded that Woodman's an asshole.
So watch out for that. Season 3 will be starting at the beginning of the year. Watch for more deranged races, more casual corner stuff coming up. That's always kind of spur of the moment. We just kind of put it together whenever we decide to put it together.
Yep. And one thing we are hoping to do in the future is have more competitive stuff.
Yes.
Rather than just Mega Man.
This is going to be a question for everybody. What do you guys think is the value of retro gaming these days? What is the point and what is the value of going back and playing all of these old games and putting them on YouTube? Let's change things up. Chris, let's start with you.
The value of retro games as a whole? Honestly, it's the philosophy that everyone keeps saying, it's all but the graphics, and that statement has never been far from being correct, because it's never been about the graphics. People look at a book, and they judge a book by its cover, and they do the same thing with games, and I don't like that philosophy. I don't agree with
That's
it
French.
Either. Mister, games to me have always been about the game itself. Now, granted, yes, there's a certain level of graphics level you do want to have, because honestly, who wants to run around as a block of one big, large, giant pixel?
Minecraft.
But there should also be a certain level of graphics level that sort of allows your mind or your imagination to take hold and put a bit of your own twist into it. It's kind of like reading a book versus watching a movie. When you watch a movie, most of the magic's taken away from you. When you read a book, your imagination fills in the void. And I think that's where retro games come in. It's like the book versus the movie.
That's a good answer. Real good answer. Ultima, what about you? What do you think is the value of retro gaming these days? Anything different?
Before I answer that, I do want to actually interject on Felon here and say, who wants to play as a block? Well, I want to be the Boshi. You play as an exclamation point trapped inside of a yellow triangle with legs and a gun.
I don't think that was the point you wanted to make.
Who would want to play as that? Apparently a lot of people. It gets speedrun a lot, apparently. But anyways, I use apparently too much.
Apparently.
So, the answer that I think is that retro gaming is always going to have its place, even in today's market, where if you look at some of the indie games out there, Risk of Rain, Crypt of the Necro Dancer, they have very pixelated, and less about graphics, than it is more about art style.
Yeah, then there's games like Binding of Isaac and Spelunky that They are just so amazing.
Yes, and speaking of Binding of Isaac, it's being re-released as Rebirth with more pixelated graphics so that they can get away from the Flash. And I think
Flash.
It's going to be...
Oh, God.
I didn't jump in there.
Well, let's do it again. Flash?
You're right yourself. But anyways, I kind of agree with Felon on a couple of those points. And it's a demonstration of... that you don't need superior horsepower under the hood to make something work. If you have gameplay to back it up, if you have the dedication, you know, and if you find something fun, play it. I don't care what game it is. If you have fun with it, play it. Unless it's Call of Duty, but we won't go into that. Anyway, I find it less about the graphics and more about the art style. As I mentioned, you know, you have games like Risk of Rain, which to have very basic pixelated art style, I mean, you have a little teeny tiny character, and you can barely tell them apart sometimes in amongst all of the action and stuff going on. And you've got games like Crypt of the NecroDancer, which I've been addicted to seriously lately, and it has a pixelated art style. Notice I said art style, not pixelated, you know, graphics. The art style is intended to look sort of retro, to my understanding. And, of course, I mean, I'm not saying that games with modern graphics are bad, you know, I mean...
Other side of this picture is that now some developers are releasing too much retro games. They just do it because it's in now, and they don't have the kind of soul like Risk of Rain does, and they don't sell.
That's true.
They just try to get with, I guess.
You're trying to
what's
capitalize
cool now.
On it.
And it doesn't work like that. You have to have soul in the game for it to work.
And that comes back to how everything comes in cycles. Like when I grew up, I actually enjoyed the He-Man TV series. And now... I liked He-Man. And they've started putting out the comics again. They started, I think, last year. And so, like, He-Man is starting to pick up and be a thing again. G.I. Joe is now starting to be a thing. They've released two movies. Transformers has come full circle, and they've got, as shitty as they are... four Michael Bay movies coming out. As shitty as they are, dude, those movies are blasphemy to my childhood. But everything comes in cycles, and I think that retro concept of like the old NES, Atari, SNES style games, they're starting to come back into fashion. And I wonder if part of that is that the children now, like, think about it. The 12-year-olds of today were born in 2002. So, they never got to experience those retro things. And I'm thinking that that's why some of this comes in cycles. Because they didn't get to experience it, and the ones that did get to experience it are now like, hey, this is what I grew up with, this is what I think would be great, and they're bringing it to the newer generations in a sort of pseudo-retro style. And I wonder if it'll happen again in, say, 20, 30 years.
It's hard to say if it will.
But retro, no matter how you dispute it, like the old retro NES, Atari, SNES, Sega Genesis-styled games, they are the... I feel like I can include Doom into this because of what it did. But they basically set the groundwork for everything that we have today.
I'm not gonna. I personally won't add anything much beyond that, but just to say that you know, like everybody else said, there's such a focus on the epic these days. You know, the bigger they just make them bigger and more bold. And you know, don't get me wrong, I love Skyrim. It's like one of my most favorite games.
Yeah,
it's not Dragon Warrior. And it doesn't do the same thing that the original Dragon Warrior did. And I used to love the original Dragon Warrior. I go back and play it now. It seems so pedestrian and so incredibly slow. But you know. Things have changed, and people seem to forget, you know, that then all this push, you know, all these bigger, better graphics and bigger, better soundtracks that, you know, you really just need some very basic elements to make it a good game. Good gameplay. Yeah. You know, the graphics should be colorful and well-representative. I think a good soundtrack is important, and Mega Man hits that on virtually every game.
Oh, yeah. You know? There's not a Mega Man with a bad soundtrack. There's really not.
No. Ten is the weakest. Ten is the weakest.
Disagree. Mega Man 2 for the Game Boy.
We're not including that game. It doesn't exist.
But you know, I do think it's important. I do think it's important for, especially, you know, like Ultima said, the newer gamers, for them to be able to know their roots and know what came before them. So I think there will always be a place for retro gaming, especially online, like we are now.
One problem with the new games are that they are so fucking long. Like, some of these games go on about 50 hours, and I'm like, I can't play this. There's not enough time. It just goes on and on. It's the same thing. You kill the same guys over and over and over and over again.
There's absolutely nothing wrong with an epic game, though, as long as you can keep your audience wanting to play the game.
Yeah, some games I just finish because I feel like I have to. Yeah.
I'll give you a good example that hit me recently was Wolfenstein: The New Order. I heard it was a very long single player campaign, and it's a single player game. It doesn't have any multiplayer to it. I don't know if they're going to patch that in at any point. I don't believe they will.
I don't think they will.
Yeah, because I don't think the game's designed for it. But anyway, the point that I'm getting at is it took me almost 30 hours to beat that game. I played it through on the hardest difficulty, and I felt rewarded at every point in the game. Like, I would get past a part, and I was like, you know, I'd be presented either with a bit more story, or it was just that relief of, damn, I actually got past that point. Now let's, you know, let's see what else they can throw at me. And the final boss, literally on its own, took me probably 4 hours.
That's rare nowadays.
Because it was that difficult, but it was that rewarding when I managed to beat the game. And I think that's partly why we do challenges, but
I'm so selective about my games. Shirox and always is like, your taste in games is bad, but I don't enjoy many games. I play some of the games, and games like Midnight Club 2, one of my favorite racing games ever, Hitman Blood Money, I play those kind of games. And the new Hitman, don't even talk about it, it's trash. But like, people play so many games in their life. I don't play that much. I don't play that many games, but the games I play a lot of them, and I repeat them because they're good. I want to go back to them.
It's important. It's a generation question. You gotta understand that concept and basic. And then we have the concept of nostalgia. And just as an example, Sonic Trilogy Genesis, Sonic 2006 PlayStation 3.
Oh wow.
Yep. Complete contrast.
When I grew up, this franchise was good. Like, this is how I remembered it. That was the shit. It was the tits. It's not like that today.
No.
What has changed? Well, obviously a lot. And it's, of course, I mean, Nintendo were smart about it. Atari, I recently watched a documentary about this, when Atari basically took the video game home consoles as an idea to earn cash on it. It's still all about money.
It's all about the money.
Yeah, that's why I told you to shut up, and this time I did. But I definitely think that certain people were more driven for what they were doing back in the day. And sure, there are crappy ass games for the NES too, and you can't help but wonder how some of them even got licensed by Nintendo. But overall, like, gaming today is gaming. It is. Back in the days, it was just about starting. Don't compare Atari to NES. I mean, Nintendo revolutionized the whole concept of video game home consoles.
Simply put, I play these games because they're better than the new games.
I think
there are exceptions.
When it comes to retro, I think the current generation, or the old generation, gets reminded by the olden days. due to the fact alone that they hold up better than the recent installments of their favorite franchises.
Yeah, I remember when Mega Man 9 came out. It was like I was 4 years old again. I got to play fresh new Mega Man game. That's about nostalgia.
So take Shikaroxen's statement a bit further. I do agree with you in the sense that a lot of the games that were developed by people who really cared about the games that they were developing, and that is true. But you have to also admit, back in the day, we had a lot of crappy titles as well.
Oh yeah.
We did. Oh yeah.
Right?
Secret Castle.
Angry Video Game Nerd has got his job well and truly kept for a while. At the same time, though, to say that games back then are better than games nowadays is not entirely true, because there are a lot of games that are coming out today that are still really good. You can tell that people really put their heart and soul into it. Most of the really, really good games that are coming out today are developed by individuals that have no company pressure put on them. Counter-Strike. You know, it's old now, but when it came out, it was a hack on another game that came out. And
yeah, it was Half-Life.
Half-Life. Another famous game that people play today, Dota. That was developed on the...
Warcraft 3 engine.
Which gave us League of Legends. A lot of those games are developed by people who really enjoy the gaming industry, and they're not just in it for the money.
And don't forget about Team Fortress 2 having come from Quake.
Yes, Team Fortress 2.
Or Team Fortress Original or Classic or whatever.
Yes. A lot of the games that actually are staples in today's world, even Doom, believe it or not, were developed by people who really wanted to get into the industry. And a lot of love and sweat pouring and all that kind of stuff went into the games that actually changed today's style of games. Some games, for example, even Portal 2, Portal 1, those games are not copied or mimicked. They are their own thing. Yet they stand out. For games to do that, to change the mold and to actually be successful because of the heart and soul that's poured into them, really says a lot. And I think during the days of retro, that's when you saw a lot of that.
I also think YouTube is quite responsible for retro being in again more than this.
It's just so much easier.
Younger people go to YouTube and they see all these old retro games being played, and they might say, hey, I want to try that out.
And naturally, you know, with parents and kids, and they might still have an old console, and it gets generation to generation. At the same time, I've seen videos today of kids 12, 13 years old, basically growing up between the 2002 or something with the PlayStation 2. They can't even get past first level of Super Mario. Some can't even make the NES work. They literally cannot figure out how to put in the cartridge and
color
it on.
My children, when they are born, if they want a brand new console, they're gonna have to beat Contra without the 30-man code first.
Yeah,
so they can have
same.
A new console.
I have my NES and my games. That's what they're gonna play.
I'm gonna wrap it up the my portion of this with one last question. Again, this will be for everybody, but you know, what do you think? Do you think that Snupsters helped to bring you guys closer together? I've heard Nico talk before about how we're a kind of family. Elaborate a little bit on that. You know, how do you think it's brought us all a little closer? Nico, let's start with you.
I do remember back in the day when we held our first races. I remember we were kind of stiff, shy and whatnot, but in the end, the experience of being together and releasing stuff, I think, has changed us for the better. I think we are all more confident.
In my defense, just real quick though, every time we seal a race, I'm still stiff. That's a boner joke.
you think I don't get it?
Thank you for clarifying, I didn't understand.
But actually, the thing that many people might not know is that we actually communicate daily. We talk about our lives, we share our day, so to speak, and we're just not faceless gamers to each other anymore.
That's right.
We know a lot of things about each other, and And I think that's what you need in order to be successful on YouTube. Without knowing who you're dealing with, it's impossible to succeed or create the kind of content that we do. And we also keep meetings fairly often to discuss our content. And I think the more time we spend together outside the YouTube episodes, the better the content we will release.
I agree. People will never know Nico and I are constantly having food wars with each other, posting. I just sent him a photo yesterday of all the glorious chicken wings that we ate.
I hate you.
But believe it or not, if we only hang out when we do the episodes, like if we never talked in between the episodes, they would be like other shit. I don't think anybody would subscribe to us.
Agreed.
But on that notion, we just crossed 100 subscribers, so yay us.
But on the same notion, if we got rid of the French Canadian, it would be up to 10k in like 2 days, I'm pretty sure.
Yes. I'm just gonna have to take it up the ass sometimes. The better you know your colleagues, the better content you create.
We get the sling insults around, and we don't take them seriously. And the fact that, you know, we're all pretty similar in the sense that we're not offended by each other's comments, and we know it's all in jest, makes it very easy for us to have conversations and laugh. And I don't think that you could actually have this group of people if somebody was easily offended in our group. It just wouldn't work.
And the same thing partly goes out to the viewers. If the viewers feel that our content is too much, they probably skip it. But our audience is probably pretty selected. It's a certain type of viewer who likes our content.
Yeah, it's definitely not mainstream for everyone, and if you're picky or get offended easily, as mentioned prior, then, well, sucks to be you.
We went down this road, this fits us, we do retro style, we have viewer discretions, advices.
Yes. And just the things we've done and the time we've spent bonding together over this. I mean, we just recently had a discussion where we all kind of opened up a bit about life experiences, and that really helped us to get to know each other better and see where we came from and what we've dealt with.
The thing is, really see it. We had a big meeting of sorts, and after that came the Deranged Moonwalk episode, and I think that's one of our best videos on YouTube right now.
Yeah.
And that's a result of a huge meeting.
That's also the result of Sheik Rocks not being in. Oh, love you, Sheik Rocks.
In my defense,
I'll edit that out.
Did you smell that smoke? Because I think that was a sick burn.
Oh, sorry, I'm out of here. Take care.
There's a fire. I will do this perfect first.
That sucks. Fire for us.
Alright, well, with that, that's the end of the Miniboss Mafia portion of this video. I'd like to thank the rest of the Snupsters for inviting me on and letting me be a part of something so great as this, and thank all of our listeners for listening, and hope you'll come and check out all the rest of our videos and watch out for more Snupster stuff and hopefully more Miniboss Mafia stuff to come in the future.
Well, this is the end of the candy bar
first part.
Yes, it's the end of the first part, and holy cow, we managed to take up 2 full hours with that.
So we had you guys send us some questions through our website. Did I get the word question right?
Yes.
I'm getting better at it.
Question.
There is a question for you, candy bars. This question is from Dick Tracy. Candy bars, your top 5 favorite console/PC games of all time.
Wow, top 5. I can tell you my number one favorite, hands down, no matter what console I'm playing it on, is Final Fantasy IV.
Yeah.
Chica Rocks and I were talking about this last night, actually. I own virtually every version of the game ever produced, except for the WonderSwan version, just because I can't seem to get it for a decent price. It is my number one pick in any situation. That's always going to be my number one game. Probably my number 2 favorite is a little-known game called Star Control 2. was originally released for the PC and was later released for 3DO, actually, of all consoles. The 3DO version is actually way superior. It's got better music and voices for the dialogue sections. That's probably my number two game. Number three, the original Unreal Tournament, just because I spent so long playing that game and got so good at it and got to so many tournaments. Definitely the original Unreal Tournament. So I guess it'd be the Game of the Year edition. That seems to be what everybody knows it as. Number four, probably Mega Man 2 is the ultimate Mega Man game, in my opinion. And it definitely deserves a place on that list. And
Blasphemer.
My last one probably had to be just about anything from the Metal Gear series. I'm a huge Metal Gear fan. The only Metal Gear game I do not like was the second one that was released for Nintendo, which it actually has no place in the storyline. That's not even part of the real series.
Which actually wasn't produced by Kojima, if I remember.
No, but it was produced by the same team. But they later decided the game sucked so bad that they actually went back to Kojima and said, can we produce a real second game with you being on the staff? And they did. They produced one for the Japanese MSX computer, which is a really good one.
Oh, yeah.
So that's my top five.
I do have another question for you, Candy Bars.
Alright.
It's from Spider Pig. What charms did the Candyman have to use on the boys to become the first Snupsitude?
What charms did I have to use? Well, mm-hmm. I could tell you, but then I'd have to kill you. definitely not my anatomy in any shape, form, or fashion, because Shika Roxanne was not involved in the selection process. So.
Oh, shit. I got charm coming straight through up my ass, I swear.
That's right, guys. That's right, guys. Shika Roxanne has no standards.
Oh, thanks. Thanks, Fallon. But no, basically, the way I became a member is... Some of you may or may not know, I'm actually a member of another group called Miniboss Mafia. Find us on YouTube or on Facebook. And I wanted to interview the Snupsters. I asked Nico if I could do an interview with them. I was going to do a podcast with them. And somehow, I wanted to sit in on one of the races just to see how things went during one of the races. And I wound up getting invited to do a video with them. I think it was a Mega Man 2 race. A casual run.
Yes, I believe so.
I think. And my recording crashed. And I don't know. It was just things seemed like such a perfect fit. You know, the personality and chemistry just got. I got along so well with all of them that they invited me back. And lo and behold, the next thing I knew, I was listed as a substitute and was part of all the proceedings going on from there. It was, you know, it really wasn't so much of a charm, just being in the right place at the right time and getting along so well with everybody who was already a member. So.
There is a follow-up to this question by Jack. He wants to know, how did the Snupsters invite you to join their family, and do you have any tips on how to get contacted by them?
Oh, there's so many ways I could answer this question. They actually sent me a Facebook message. it was how they asked me to join. It was, you know, it said, would you like to join us for a video? That was how they... asked me to join. As for tips for how to become a member, one sense, it just seems like, you know, you got to be able to have the same type of chemistry with the group. You know, you don't want to come across as being too overeager or just, you know, I don't know. It's kind of a hard thing to put into words, but there's a certain personality type that the group seems to look for that just fits really well. And, you know, obviously we want to make sure we're not getting, you know, little kids involved in this. You know, we're all kind of adults here. You know, we don't want to be responsible for corrupting some little kid. Shika Roxanne does that enough in his spare time. We don't need to bring that to the...
And we did get contacted by people saying our content is insultive, it's harsh, and all I can say is go fuck yourselves.
I'm proud. That's good.
That sounds like...
mission accomplished.
Yes.
No, yeah, that sounds like parents not doing their jobs and making sure that they're watching... or checking out what their kids are watching and then punishing their kids for it, and not us.
Yeah, we did add the viewer discretion is advice at the beginning of the video, so we can't do anything else for you.
But if I had any tips for someone who wanted to think about joining, the best thing I could tell you would be, you know, contact
bribes.
The group.
Bribes.
Yeah, bribes are good. Shika Roxanne loves naked men pictures, that always helps. but approach the group, send an email, and don't just be like, you know, oh, I love you guys so much, I want to be a part of what you do, but be like, you know, this is what I like, this is what I do, I really think I could bring something to this group, and just, tell us how you think you can make our family bigger, and how you can make it better. And I think that would be the best way to be approached by us, is, you know, give us a reason to contact you.
Yeah, find a way to catch our attention, and we will come for you.
Also, on a side note, substitute was my term. Nico hated it, and he's like, no, we can't use it, we're not using it, and then it just stuck.
Yeah, prostitute. I will read the question sent by you, Candy Bars. From the Snupsters, who gets the most real sex? If we count Felon's cat, then it's Odie.
He's a player!
Or she Gregson's asshole. I don't even think it's live.
That one is still hard.
I think that's as far as we're gonna answer the question.
I almost forgot that I submitted that question. That was like right after I asked you guys if I could do an interview. I was like, you know what? They could appreciate this, and that's why I sent it.
That's why it's in the show.
That's probably why I'm a member too. I'm less concerned about your game playing abilities and more who gets the most action.
Oh, so you're worried about our game playing abilities and then our game playing abilities.
That's right.
You gotta make sure that joystick motion practice is still good. I mean,
Shika rocks and practices every night, so we know he's good and solid.
Yes.
So good he sets his apartment on fire.
Well, it does get awful hot when you're working the joystick that
way. Jesus.
Now we know how he set the fire.
This is fun. I actually do have an NES advantage.
I will never come to your place and play with your NES advantage.
I don't know if that was said on purpose or if it was just like an accidental stumble, but that was great.
That was great.
You're free.
All right, guys, well, I got to go. Thanks, everybody, for listening. I hope you guys have all enjoyed this. I know we've become a lot closer as a group, especially over this past year, and looking forward to seeing what the future brings. Mm. All right, see you guys later.
See you, Candy Waiters. Gordon the Destroyer asks, if you had to play the game you despise most, what would it be?
If we had to, I'd choose death.
The game I despise most, wow.
It's gotta be somewhere in the Mylan Secret Castle area or a Silver Surfer.
That's similar to where I'm thinking. I have another one though, and that would definitely be every Call of Duty from about the fourth one on.
Hitman Absolution.
Either Digimon World on the PSX or Resident Evil.
Really? No, wow, I didn't know you didn't like that.
Also, yeah, you make me play the new Need for Speed, so I'll kill you.
I got 500 horror movies on my PC. And, you know, I'm a fanatic. I watch everything. From the 20s or from the 2000s, I don't care. I love gore, I love everything. But I can't play horror games for shit. If you remember the first zombie cutscene on the original PlayStation, with Resident Evil 1,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But when you see that close in on the zombie, I think eating off some flesh or something,
it's eating a former Bravo member.
Yeah, I just can't deal with that shit at all. And I actually went through half of Dead Space. I'm proud enough of that.
That was like genuinely horrifying.
Yeah.
Like, the fact that you can't just kill the things, you have to, like, shoot the limbs off first.
My ex forced me to play this title in front of her with, like, in the late night, everything unlit. I screamed like a little sissy girl.
I'm assuming this is why she's an ex now.
No.
Doom 3. There's a simple reason for that. And I think Ultima can guess why.
Because it's not Doom 1 and Doom 2.
No, it is the littered with fucking jump scares.
Oh, that part.
That makes a game dull. Doesn't make a game good.
No, it doesn't. Yeah. When you're playing through a game, you want to immerse yourself in a... Yeah. Shit does, you know, just it breaks the the immersion.
I don't think, like, taking that out of the equation, the game is meant to have a sort of more creepy feel. So the jump scares, at least maybe not as many, would have been really nice to, I mean, you know, it's still kept. They did have a lot of jump scares, and it's not obviously my favorite Doom game, but it's not, I wouldn't say it's a bad game. I mean, it's still got really positive reviews for the creepy atmosphere and all of that. Criticized for, and this is the thing about Doom 3 that blows my mind. Everybody's like, well, this game is too dark, so everybody made the duct tape mod. And then they released BFG Edition, which had a shoulder-mounted flashlight. Everybody goes, shoulder-mounted flashlight was stupid. They should have added that. Make up your mind, people!
So what we're agreeing on here is that apparently Chris would rather do a 24-hour marathon on Silver Surfer. Moving on, Nico.
Well, and me and Nico both think that Mylan's Secret Castle's a shitty game.
Yeah, I don't want to, like, keep shooting bubbles. Like,
dude, you have to memorize the game to beat the game. That's not fun.
Actually, I also
that statement's half incorrect.
You don't have to know it. You just shoot bubbles and see what happens. Yeah. Next question from Mama Need Some Fillin. Are you single?
Am I single? Yes.
Somebody might be asking that for their own reasons, and they might contact you after this, Fillin. I would be careful.
I've got my junk mail filter on.
Ouch. That's harsh. This is from Kitsune. Have you guys ever thought of doing races with more unusual side objectives added for fun?
What was the question? In Swedish?
You know? In Swedish? Thank you.
Men kulle kalle kille i munnen.
He said Swedish. Okay. Not made up baby language.
We do have Deranged. That's where we have unusual side objectives. I don't know when this question was actually sent.
Side objectives,
probably things like Mega Man 5, collecting all the letters.
Yeah, and probably our Season 3 that has some side objectives, so to speak. But if you want to check for unusual races, keep an eye on the Deranged series. It's one of our best series, I think.
Mm-hmm.
How do you guys pay for the giveaways each month? Are you a part of the YouTube partnership and earn cash on these videos?
As far as I know, we pay for them out of pocket.
Yes, from our pockets. From Shinobson's pockets.
Yep.
Yeah, I actually am responsible for, 99.8% of the giveaways.
And we do earn money from the videos, but it doesn't even cover our yearly domain charges yet. So we're talking about pennies here.
Yeah, I can't even buy one package of condoms a year.
Ouch.
Not even used condoms.
I'm not sure that's a good thing or a bad thing.
I don't know how to pronounce this, but Tero42. Sorry if I got that wrong. Will you guys consider playing Mega Man 7, 8, or the X series? Thanks and keep up the awesome videos.
7 next series for sure.
What's wrong with 8?
8 I think is actually better than 7 on like miles better than 7.
Yeah, I've never like played 7 or 8, but I do like the idea of playing or raising them. So we might do it in the future.
The biggest thing I don't like about 7 is they really shrunk down your screen real estate. And for Mega Man 8, it feels like they did the exact opposite, where they gave you way more screen real estate and everything.
I think that's just mainly
like so small.
Also a problem with the SNES. They wanted to make the graphics big, colorful, because it's the Super Nintendo and that's the cost.
Well, what they should have done with 7, in my opinion, this is just my opinion, is that they should have made the graphics more like X. Like, Mega Man should have been about the size of X as far as screen size goes, and kept all the same mechanics, obviously, the slide and all of that. And just kept everything, like, proportionate. The art style in 7 is freaking awful, and I realized that they were trying to go for a more comic feel with the graphics because of the, I think, the manga and everything that was out at the time, but it just didn't work. It made everything feel awkward.
But what we are trying to say that we will probably play these games in the future.
At some point. At some distant future, I'm sure.
I will be added to my challenge list, so you'll be seeing 7 and 8.
Okay. I've already started doing perfects on 7, let's just say that.
So check the channels for your Mega Man 7 and 8 goodness. Matt asks, or says, Nico, your helium voice has become a thing. Say hello for Matt.
Hello, Matt.
It just reminds me of that scene from Borderlands 2 where you sometimes open the weapons menu and the gun guy, Marcus, is like, catch a gun! Never doing that again!
Oh, yeah.
Pat has a question for Ultimamento.
Oh.
Oh, is this not even a question? Oh, well, I'll read it. I picture you as a little hamster who has overalls. Don't have a question, though. Do I need one? Okay, here is one. What is your favorite Doom game?
What is my favorite Doom game? Okay, well, I'm glad that I am reminding you of a little hamster with overalls, because that's actually kind of a cute thing to think about, so I guess that's a good thing. My favorite Doom game, are we talking official or, like, just also including everything that's been modded over the years?
Let's say both.
Okay. Official releases, it would be a toss-up between the Ultimate Doom and the Plutonia Experiment. I like the Ultimate Doom because it has some of the best map compilations you'll find anywhere. The fact that Episode 4 really doesn't have a feel, it just kind of is a hodgepodge of locations. It gave you the difficulty aspect, everything kept ramping up in difficulty over the course of the game. Like, the first episode of Ultimate Doom, you're on a moon base, and, you know, you're trying to get to the source of the corruption. And then you end up at the second moon base, where everything has started to be taken over by hell, so it's sort of a hybrid point. Then you actually go to hell in the third episode. And the fourth episode is, at least theoretically, supposed to be that sort of limbo going back from hell back to Earth as a transition period to go into Doom 2.
So yet to answer really the question, no, you didn't have to have a question.
No. But that's... I like Doom because it feels like an actual successful story of levels. And it has amazing gameplay to it, no matter what. You actually felt like the bosses were bosses. Anyways, the Plutonia Experiment has amazing map sets. And the gameplay in them is just spot on for what needs to be done. The architecture was just visually appealing, and it was designed with that difficulty curve in mind of, oh, well, you've already played a lot of Doom, here, try and beat this. But as far as unofficial stuff, it would be Alien Vendetta, hands down.
Nico, you need to do the invitation now.
I like Doom.
There you go, done.
The next question comes from Pig Bazooka, really? Oh well. Why are you angry all the time, Shigaroxen? Relax.
I'm with these guys, what can I say?
Do you feel hatred in your soul?
Yes.
Felon, Curious87 wants to know, how did you join Snupster? Did Nico ask you, and how did he do it?
By accident. Do I regret the decision? No.
So it's like Nico's lost son. Moon.
The quick truth answer is I was invited by Nico and Shikaroxen, actually them as a collective.
Googly Eyes has another one for Shikaroxen. Does your nickname or part of it mean something in Swedish? Where did you come up with it?
No, actually it partially means something in Japanese. I googled this once, but really? I can't remember. Yeah, it was nothing out of the ordinary or whatever. It's actually an anagram between my name and a friend of mine. mixed with a couple of other letters just to make sense of it.
To create an ultimate nickname that nobody else has for a reason.
He basically organized a bunch of beer wine bottles together and he's like, okay, first letter from each of these.
You're gonna get your nickname like on every service you want. It's never taken.
I know, I love it. I used to go by God Hand, but apparently that one can be taken.
Yeah, because it's also the name of a weapon in God Fantasy.
No, it's also a game. I think it's more related to the character of the Square Enix / Namco beat 'em up they released on PlayStation back in the 90s.
I know what you're talking about. Wait. Can I guess? Air Guys.
Yes.
Marcus says, just finished watching your casual corner of Mega Man Unlimited episode, and I would love to see you add it to this season's Mega Man race. Done. Actually.
Done deal. Done. It's happening.
Mega Man Unlimited will be part of Season 3 as a episode race. This comes from Tero42. Not a question, but for a Mega Man Deranged or a casual corner playthrough, you guys want to try Creon Conquest? A straight up ripoff of Mega Man in drag. I don't know if I want to touch this game now.
So this is a hack again?
No, it's not a hack, actually. It is a unauthorized... actually, I guess it is hack because it came out when the NES was actually live. And I played at the beginning of it. It's not one of those select a stage games. You just start out and you go through it by stage. And you can shoot up and things like that. In terms of doing a challenge on it...
We will look into this. Tero also says, keep up with the good work. Thanks again. And Nico, would you consider adding a forum section to the Snupster webpage? We have been over this, and I can say that not yet. Maybe if we get more views, it's a possibility. But at this given moment,
to subscribe before somebody else does.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Ish. Moving on.
I don't know why that was funny. Yes.
Courage, the Cowardly Dog, asks if my fiance enjoys games such as Mega Man as well. She has beaten Heat Man and Flash Man, actually. Not perfect, no miss, but yeah, she does.
That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, she's a keeper.
From Gregor Man. Do all of you guys happen to have a Steam account, PS3, Xbox 360, or Wii U? If you do, would you think about giving Cloudberry Kingdom a try? It's a four-player co-op, hard-as-hell platformer that's a ton of fun. I know you all play competitively, but this can be co-op and competitive at the same time. I watched
what
you guys...
What was the name here?
Cloudberry Kingdom.
I've watched guys on another channel play this, and I think you guys would be even more fun to watch play this game. Would you think giving it a go on a casual play, or even put a co-op like this under a new category?
I'm looking at, oh my god, yes it does look hard. This is absolutely ridiculous.
But to answer your...
What in the...
God.
Oh my god!
That is bullshit.
Oh my god. It's on Steam, just type in Cloudberry Kingdom.
Yeah.
I don't have a PS3, I don't have an Xbox. I only have the NES and the original PlayStation, but I do have a Steam account.
I have a Steam account, and I also
have
a PS3 account that I've not logged into in like a year.
Sadly though, I keep my Steam account, I keep my closest friends in it. Does the game look like we should go at it?
I think we should at least give it a try.
I think we should... I'm gonna catch it for all of us during a sale at some point, I guess.
Well then, you got your wish, Gregorman.
Oh god.
It just looks so freaking ridiculous.
To answer the question, we can play it. Will we be successful? Probably not, due to latency issues. We are halfway across the world from each other.
Yeah. That's an issue.
Snupsters team up.
SPD7693 asks, Nico, at what time of the day in Finland do you usually start the races? It won't be easy to bear the time difference, as everyone is living in different time zones. We usually start at 11 a.m. or 11 p.m. Finnish time. That's... if it's 11 a.m., that's like 5 a.m. for Ultima.
Yep.
And what is it for Phelan?
Most of the time when we start our races, it is...
2
a.m.?
Yeah, it'd be 2 a.m.
Yeah, but right now that works best for us.
Right, basically, I'm 1 hour away from Nico.
I'm like seven hours. Yeah, I'm 7 hours behind Nico.
And Chris should be 10.
3 hours behind me.
Yeah. We
so you're
somehow
looking at time
fine.
Zones of almost 11 hours difference.
Yep.
Yeah. Still works out.
Yep. Yeah, by the time most of us are waking up, most of us are crashing.
Yeah.
How do you even pronounce this? Zlatku. Zlatku. Which control pads do you play with?
PlayStation 2, DualShock 2.
Xbox One.
PlayStation 3.
Unreal Gamer asks Shikroxen, how are you feeling about that house fire?
you know what? I've quit smoking.
Is it because of that?
Start?
But that's not what causes fire, we confirm that.
The Elite NES Guys asks if we are ever gonna do another competitive race series other than Mega Man.
There has been discussions, and we will be looking over a couple of franchises and or titles to expand the inventory.
Yeah, he's suggesting like Castlevania or Ghosts and Goblins. Funny thing about Ghosts and Goblins.
Oh my god.
We had an episode of Ghosts and Goblins, we sucked at it, we trashed it.
It doesn't make for a good episode.
No. I can say that we will have more competitive series to come.
I would love to do Castlevania in future. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, me too.
I'd love to do Ninja Gaiden, but some people don't want to play it.
Legally Blind Gamer for Ultima Mantoid. Have you considered doing Mega Man V for the Game Boy in your Mandy style runs?
I think I already answered that question by posting up Splash Woman. All of the bosses from Mega Man V, including Terra, is in the list. They are towards the bottom before you get to Street Fighter Cross Mega Man.
There we go.
Attention to detail. Quickman/bitch asks, can any of you guys tell me if racing Mega Man pantsless grants me good luck?
We always race Mega Man pantsless.
I've never seen pants.
Pants, what are those?
Look how good I do.
Is that what a dog does? And, you know, they're always pants.
Morpheus132. Nico, how did you decide to get Neo's look from the Matrix? I don't think I decided.
No, he's just going bald. I mean...
Yes. I'm actually not. Did you actually know that Keanu Reeves is like 50 years old?
He's getting older.
He looks like 20 though.
Yeah, he doesn't age.
No, not at all. Capitano Caveman. Shikroxen, could you ever see yourself living in America? And why or why not?
No. Never. I don't believe that for shit.
Why?
Chris would
why?
Like to ask.
There are certain factors that would be fun for the sake of it, but there are more so negative factors that just wouldn't work.
Chris would like to ask, would you go and live in Canada?
It's pretty much the same thing except for all the stories.
At some point there were actually plans of moving there due to a certain factor, but that is no longer up for discussion.
Kibbles asks us, what do we do for a living? I work in IT.
I sell body parts.
Your own.
I do a job similar to the Ross. Is it Ross in there?
Roy.
Roy? No. What?
We're talking about IT crowd.
IT crowd, yeah.
Roy.
No, it's Moss and...
Roy.
Yeah, Roy. Yes. It's been a while since I've watched it and you've answered it so many times, yes. I do a job similar to Roy in the movie. Have you turned and turned off the computer yet?
Why is there a coffee in your disc tray? I thought it was a cup holder.
my PC doesn't work. Is it on?
I'm a restaurant chef.
Mm-hmm.
There you go.
An ultimate.
Honest answer from Shika Roxen. I am not a restaurant chef, but I am the food industry's bitch. That's the easiest way to put my job. I'm not... I work in a kitchen for a pizza restaurant. I will leave it unnamed. But I work in pizza, and it... I literally feel like every waking day I go into work and I just want to just hang myself out in the dining room lawn.
That's nice.
I hate my job.
Ultimate Mantroid, that floor is not clean until I could see my own reflection in it.
Oh, yeah,
yeah, no, you're not getting that. I'm going home.
I enjoy every morning I wake up knowing the fact that I have to play with knives all day and cut things.
Mostly himself.
The amazing Pyro asks Felenor. I don't know if this is a question or not.
Good
at first
grief, I thought he was going to have a question for me. Thank you, Lord.
Phew, that was close. At first.
You get a Pyro joke.
Question
Jesus
averted.
Christ, I will have to repeat all of this. The amazing Pyro for Felen. At first, you seemed a lot more silent and shy, but you've grown into a more confident individual with some traits from the other Snupsters. Do you feel like you've changed during the time you've been a member?
I would like to probably answer that by saying I feel I've grown into more of a comfort zone with who I am, more so than becoming or copying their traits. I've always had those traits. I've just been... When I started, I was just hesitant and shy. That's really it, and I've grown more comfortable, and now you get to see more of the true me.
So, in a sense, you have come out of the closet?
Nice try.
Yeah, I'm not even going to give you points for that. Fuck you.
Okay, now pay attention. MacDoody says, breaking news just in. Mega Man 11 coming next summer. The Snupsters, alongside a promising Snupstitute, are designing 5 never-before-seen robot masters with the most mind-blowing skills. Go.
We need 5 robot masters. We need candy bars.
Okay,
so...
So
let's do 4, since candy bars took
no,
a bar
it's,
up his...
It's fine. It's Candyman. Done.
Oh.
Candyman. Robot masters designed by us with amazing abilities.
Ketchup Man.
Ketchup Man, yes!
When you fall behind, he helps catch you up.
Yeah, he's so like the Mega Dragon, he comes from behind.
So yes. Would the weapon for Ketchup Man be like the tomato shot?
T-shot.
T-shot?
That's the best thing I've ever
it's
come up with.
Better than the C-shot.
Yes, it is. Everything is better than the she-shot.
She sells seashells by the seashore. I know, I butchered that on purpose.
Don't you fucking hit me, man.
Well, if we're gonna answer seriously, I actually have come up with ideas for bosses myself, and I will name. I'll give you an idea for one. Also, it is copyright. If you make a fan-made game, I request permission for it.
Copyright snupster.com.
There you go. One of the ideas I've come up with is a Puppet Man, basically a robot master that is two parts, Puppet Master and Puppet. The puppet itself is indestructible and you have to kill the Puppet Master. However, to hit the Puppet Master, you have to basically dismantle the puppet. And the ability that you would get from him is some sort of like puppet weapon, which allows you to control enemies and make them jump into the pits.
That's nice.
That doesn't sound overpowered or anything.
Yeah.
Hey, Dr. Wily, I've got your weakness right here.
I was actually manipulating Wily the whole time.
He jumps back in his UFO and flies away. Dumb.
If I had to do one, well, see, I'm torn between two ideas that I've always had. So I guess if you want to throw another one out there, go for it, Phil, and I'll throw my two out there.
The other one that I had is actually fairly simple, Spaceman. He's very similar to Zine, I guess, in a sense of Dynamo Man with a big spherical orb over his head.
Oh yeah, the Space Dome thing.
Yeah, the Space Dome. and his weapon would be basically just crash a meteorite, but not like, you know, Astro Man's meteorites. Just basically just a single horizontal downward angled meteorite. Gotta have the simple weapon sometimes.
Oh yeah. I guess the two that I had in mind, one would be Mirage Man. Is basically like some sort of desert-themed robot who had the ability to just duplicate himself, kind of like Gemini Man, but it wasn't like a permanent thing. There'd be like two of him, and only one of them would be the real one, because it's a mirage. So mm-hmm. That'd be kind of the idea. And of course, the weapon would be like either Mega Man himself would like blend in sort of with the background like a mirage, like he'd kind of become fake and he could just walk through shots or certain enemies, which of course if you're gonna do that you would need a boss that's weapon would do damage to itself, like in a way like it goes through the mirage or something and bounces back, or you just make a fake Mega Man that kind of like the copy vision. The other one obviously would be Mantis Man, which basically would have, like, instead of a buster, you know, like a buster cannon, it would have, like, sort of the mantis-like pincers. And I always thought it would be cool if he threw, like, an electric replica of, like, a pincer, and it would, like, spin towards the target. And if it hit a wall, it would cause the wall to electrify. So I thought that would be cool.
Similar to Sigma from X4.
You know, now that you mention it, yeah. Kind of in a way, yeah.
I've always found a day robot master that can control weather somehow. Not just like Toadman's acid rain, but something like Monsoon Man or something.
Something like Cloud Man, so to speak. The weapon weather orbs.
Yeah. Like sunburn, different weather hazards.
So you would have a weatherman and his powers would be telling you what the weather is for tomorrow and the 3-day yes. forecast following.
Shigarok doesn't have anything in mind.
Yes.
That's all.
Oh,
here.
You
want
to
yes.
share it? Okay.
Yeah, he's going to have Delay Man, and his power is going to be delayed.
Go fuck yourself, man.
Well, that, or I could just talk continuously for 6 minutes without interruption like Casey. What I want from, if they were to do a new classic Mega Man, I want them to go back to the roots of Rock, Paper, Scissors. I'm looking at the title selection of Mega Man 4 bosses, and it, on top of my head, Mega Man 6, I mean, bullshit. How the fuck are you supposed to figure out the order by logic, is looking at the screen.
It has never been about logic.
They all were logic with fire and ice and electric. I want them to go back to elements in some order, way, or fashion.
Hmm. You know, I've also kind of agreed with that. Also, at the same time, though, I think weapon weaknesses based on boss strategy. For example, if a boss is in the air most of the time, a weapon that shoots in the air should actually be the weakness.
Yep. And not the weapon that's least likely to be used against it. Or the hardest to use against it.
Yeah, something like a close
P-ball
range weapon.
On
like,
Wily.
Well, there's P-Ball, Wily, and the plant barrier against Tomahawk Man. Mm-hmm. Because you have to go against the AI. The AI says keep your distance, and the weapon says get really fucking close.
That was a fun question. I like that one.
Yep. Blobulus 89. What's up with the bomb with the ridiculously big mustache? It's totally cool, but I was thinking if I missed an old joke or something. You guys are the bomb.
I think
this
Nico,
is yours.
This one's all you.
Yeah.
Since a snup is an F-bomb, thus a bomb was born. And we kind of stick to it.
And the F? The F does not stand for what you think it stands for. It actually stands for Fu Manchu. Mm-hmm. So, obviously, the bomb got a mustache.
Yeah. Nice. Good save.
I totally made that shit up.
And the pigtail at the end is in representation of Windman, because he has it too. And mm-hmm. it just makes him... Oh, it might be a fuse. Shit, I didn't think this through.
All we can say is it's a bomb, and it's a bomb. The logo is a bomb. Takashi Yonichua asks, so when are you gonna meet up for some face-to-face races, or have you already?
When somebody gives us free airfare, because exactly. I know we'd probably all meet at Nico's house.
And actually, we'll most likely meet up at some point in the not-so-far future, I believe.
I would like to meet up with everybody and have some sort of thing.
It has been,
you know.
Talks.
I think the realistic answer would be that we would have to become popular enough to go to a convention where we'd have enough of a fan base to actually justify a trip. In
yeah.
which case, we would all meet in one central location as opposed to all meet each other at each other's houses.
Never know what's gonna happen, though.
Never know.
Gregaman asks if we will ever learn it the table.
Well, I think...
Gregaman asks if we will ever release a DVD of our races. Right now, no.
Due to copyright issues and
that
the YouTube stuff, it's probably going to be difficult.
It's not entirely out of question, though. It can still be done. But there will have to be...
some modifications for sure on the episodes.
Yes. But it demand first, I guess, is needed. And it has to be a set amount of people, and we'll see what we can do about production actually going through with the project, but...
Right now I don't think it's necessary though, you have...
Nope.
You have all at your fingertips, you can download the clips from YouTube. And you can have it in your PC. Frying Pan asks, what are your best NES memories from your childhood?
Bubble. Going through the Guardian Legend.
I would say my favorite game on the NES is still Nintendo World Cup. That has the most memories for me. It's just not about the game, it's about the memories that surround the game.
Obviously, I did mention that the NES was Mega Man 2, but... For the Super Nintendo, though, that one's a bit more tough. I probably would have to side with probably one of the Mega Man X games, but I couldn't tell you which one because they're all three, like, amazing.
My favorite memories for me are probably...
I heard a cat.
I'd have to say it would probably be Ninja Gaiden beating the games. The stories, that you know, it is kind of like a story mode game and...
Yeah.
For me, that actually has a lot of strong influence with where my name came from some other stuff. It's a long story.
Become a man.
Actually, that's genetics.
There's another NES game I do want to mention that has some fun, fond memories. They were both wrestling games, but one of them was WWF Challenge. And the reason that this game has fond memories is because, the game had a tendency to bug out, and I'd play it a lot with my uncle. So, like if you got thrown out of the ring, it would start, a 20 count before you had to get back in the ring. And sometimes we would do it just right, and somebody would get thrown over the ring, and it wouldn't start that count. And then the character would ghost, and you could just walk out into the audience and just, walk around. And we would always try and get us... do that, and it would cause the game to bug out in such a way that sometimes you couldn't pin the person, and if you did, sometimes it would put the person that was doing the pinning outside of the ring, and it would start that 20 count. So we had all sorts of fun because of the buggy coding in that game. The other one was actually WCW wrestling, and it was just funny because you'd put somebody in a submission hold and it would shake the whole screen and it'd give you some weird noise that went with it. Was like when you were doing that, but sometimes heads would get chopped off and they'd be outside the ring. So we had funny stuff going on. Of course, this was another one. I played it with my uncle and my cousin when he would come
right
over
there and just ask who the fuck distributed and published that game.
I will look.
Games.
It will change.
I will look just for you since you asked. FCI Incorporated.
Who?
In other words, their one and only title. I wonder why they went bankrupt.
And the other one was WrestleMania Challenge. That was the name of it. And it was done by LJN.
Oh, my
God. Oh, God. That makes perfect sense now. That's
I'm done with you, Ultimate. I'm sorry, I cannot be...
You need to pitch this with LJN Defender.
That's why I enjoyed it so much, is because it's so bad. It's so buggy.
Fine, we have our last question. Toasty Raccoon asks, what gaming consoles do you have? Any consoles you're still saving up for? I have PlayStation 1 and the NES, and I occasionally play my PSP. But that's about it. That's what I have. I'm a PC man.
I have a PSP, I have a PlayStation 2, I also have an Xbox 360.
I just want to go ahead and ask versions of actual consoles. So what versions of PSP and the 2?
I have the... I don't know about the 2. I have the red Xbox that was released with Resident Evil 5. And I have the original PSP, heavily modded and able to do whatever the hell I want with it.
The fat PSP.
Other than that, it's a Game Boy DS, which has a broken hinge. One day I may repair it. And a PC.
Which is not a console.
We're doing all consoles, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. I have an NES front loader. Yes, I have a list. I have an NES front loader. I have a Sega Genesis Model 2 somewhere. Don't know where.
Oh, good grief.
I gave that one to my brother. I have a Super Nintendo. I have a Game Boy Advance somewhere. I have a Nintendo DS, which has a broken hinge. I have a Nintendo 64. I have a PSP version 2. I have a Nintendo Wii. I have a Nintendo GameCube. I have a PlayStation 1. I have a portable PlayStation 1, both versions.
That's fucking sad.
How long is this going to take?
I have, I have a ColecoVision still somewhere. I still have an Atari, but I think it's the 2600.
Okay.
You're rolling the credits right now, right, Nico?
Yes.
I have a Nintendo 3DS. I have a PlayStation 1, a portable PlayStation 1, a PlayStation 2, and a PlayStation 3.
The funny thing about saving up to a console, I'd probably like to get this Sega Genesis to see what I missed. And also I would possibly like to get the Super Nintendo.
I just remembered one. Brace yourself. I own it. A 32X for the Sega Genesis.
That's not a console. That's a mod.
It has its own power adapter. In its defense, it should have been its own console with the Sega Saturn.
I guess so. I'll give you half a point.
It should have been.
Half a point.
But it had its own game collection that you couldn't play, so I guess it kind of was its own console at the same time it wasn't. It was like in the middle.
I have the Nintendo Wii, which is still backwards compatible. I have the GameCube. I have a recently purchased 3DS, and it's the 3DS XL, which I purchased yesterday. I used to have the original XL, and I used to have the original 3DS. Now I have the 3DS XL. So, you know. I have the original PlayStation 1. I have the Slim PS2, I used to have the original. I got rid of my PlayStation 3, which was the original. I have the Slim PlayStation Portable. Vita can suck my ass, try. Through a straw. It's so bad.
True words have never been spoken.
You have been listening to the first ever Snupster.com podcast. I hope you enjoyed.
I need to pee.
Take it, guys. I'm sure we'll do this again.
Thanks for sticking around and watching, or rather listening.
Yep. We will catch you on the next episode.
Take care, everyone.